Well, I'd like to welcome everybody to the March 22nd meeting of the Finance Committee here in South Deerfield, Massachusetts. We've got a couple things still printing out in the back, so Doug will be joining us shortly, but I guess I thought we'd start with the minutes from the previous meeting. I passed out copies to everyone from last week, and you know, as usual, let me know if you see anything that jumps out at you or needs to be amended or changed. I guess that's the same thing.
Make a motion, we accept it as printed.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. The second thing I think I'll do here is to read out something Doug has just given to me. And I think ideally we'll talk about this later, either later tonight or next week, but at least want to put it out there, and I'll hand out, I have a couple of copies. This is from the previous select board meeting. There were a couple of items, things they talked about that related or were directed towards us for our thoughts. One, the board agreed to recommend to the finance committee that the town pay the energy loan off in full using free cash. So something we've talked about, we said we'd wait till we got a little closer to sort of decide. And, you know, again, I still think maybe that's when we pick up next week as we've gone through some of these other budgets, but that's out there, and the select board, that's their kind of position on it. And the other item is regarding the school resource officer. And this says, the necessity and cost of the school resource officer was discussed. Mr. Gilmore suggested that the board recommend a reduction to the Frontier Regional School and Deerfield Elementary School budgets in order to offset the cost to the town for this position. That was moved by Ms. Ness and seconded by Mark Gilmore to recommend what I just said, to reduce the two school budgets by a total of $15,000 in order to offset the cost of the school resource officer. So again, two things that we'll definitely want and need to discuss. And here I have two copies if you guys want to see any of the wording there. Doug, anything more to add on that?
The second recommendation from the Board of Selectmen, that came organically from the members of the board. Mm-hmm. I insisted that they vote on it, and I did not comment on it.
Okay.
I don't want to comment on it here either.
Fair enough.
Because I don't live in Deerfield, and I don't pay taxes, and I don't have children in the schools.
Okay. So. Well, you know, something we definitely want to pick up, and whether it's later tonight or at a future meeting, we'll definitely be responding to and discussing that. Doug, do we have the numbers for the that one other budget we wanted to vote here, the Medicare expense budget?
I believe the numbers that you have are accurate, but they're in the packet that was just handed out. So,
okay.
Or that will be handed out.
I think almost everybody has one.
Do we have enough copies? So basically, this is a budget.
Two here, two there. There's one there at the center.
This budget has not changed. There was some discrepancy as to whether some of the offsets needed to change, and it turns out they do not. It is good as it stands. So this is budget number 916-5400, Medicare insurance expenses. And the question surrounded South County EMS, if there should be an offset for their expenses on here. As it turns out, with Barbara and Zach, and I think Doug as well looking into it, they get billed separately through their own health, I don't know if provider's the right word, but they get billed separately, so there should not be an offset. They'll get their own bill and pay it.
Correct. Good. So the bottom line number should read 86570. There's one offset in that budget for wastewater treatment of about $2,200.
Does anyone have any questions on this one?
No.
Anyone want to make a motion then on this?
I'll make a motion that we approve it.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. So the, I guess, main topic for tonight's meeting is the South County EMS budget, which has been handed out, and hopefully a couple of people we'll be here shortly to have that discussion with us. Doug is printing out a couple more copies of the budget. And if we do have some time, there are certainly other things we can talk about. We can start with.
Sorry.
You guys need one of these over there still? I guess why don't we circle back maybe to the energy loan as discussed from the board and their recommendation to pay it off in full. Does anyone have any kind of new information or thoughts on that? I mean, for me, I still would like to see a little bit.
We have available on free cash.
Well, that's what I'd like to get a few more of the budgets voted on and together so we can take a look at what our options are under various scenarios of paying off or not. But, you know, I don't really have
it. We have adequate free cash. I don't mind paying it off because that's one less thing we got to worry about.
Right.
Right. I'm with Dylan. I'd like to just kind of put a hold on it to see where we are a little bit further down the road. But if we have that option, I think it'd be, I agree. I think it'd be the way to go.
Nice to clean it up.
Yeah, to clean it up and be done with it.
It's got to go to town meeting one way or the other. So
right.
And I would prefer that we, if we have the money, so if we need to take a vote at this point in time, then I would move that we pay it off. And if it turns out that we can't afford it later, then we'll backtrack when we're, but we got to take some action someplace along the way.
Okay. How do other people feel about that?
I like to wait.
To wait?
I'm with Jeff.
Okay.
Because we really don't know what's happening. We haven't got any totals,
well,
really.
We may know by the end of the night because, Doug, it seemed to me that there was a lot of financial information in the...
Could we just wait then until the end of the evening
meeting.
And see where we're at?
You'd be smart.
All right, so let's table that one then. Doesn't seem to be any new information other than wanting to see where we stand. I think everybody's of a similar opinion. If there is capacity to pay it off, we'd just as soon do that and clean it up. Here's one other thing I will hand out. That I just received tonight. So this is an email related to a salary survey, looking at the different positions within town government and compensation relative to other similar positions in other towns in the area. Again, I don't think there's anything here that we're going to be taking action on immediately, but at least it is a beginning to put together some data to look at a salary schedule and any changes that may need to be made to it, either in this year or future years.
I can actually give you the crib notes, and I would actually direct your attention to the backside of that. There's a section speaking about the town accountant. By various estimates, it can be determined that the town accountant is either paid at a rate 37% lower than other town accountants in other towns near us, or more of a percentage lower, 40%, 42%, 44%, 45%. Our town accountant is being paid to do full-time town accountant control and expenditure control work, as well as interface with our auditors on an annual basis, and all the reporting to the state that goes along with managing the accounts of a town, for the same rate that the COG pays a data entry clerk.
Seems like COG is paying a lot of money, doesn't it?
No.
Data entry.
Well, for data entry, perhaps. I'll give you that. The only comparable references that we have are for Montague, for Greenfield, and there's one other town that has hired their own accountant, and those people are making anywhere from $7 to $13 or so dollars more per hour than our accountant is. Mm-hmm. And they're people who are working full-time or within full-time range, so they're getting full benefits out of that. So.
And can you speak to, because obviously the other big discrepancy here is the number of hours being worked, like some of these... If I'm reading this right, the ones that are being outsourced to FERCOG are working 6 to 10 hours per week. So are those towns able to do all the things that need to be done?
No.
How are they doing the rest?
That's for the general bill paying. That's basically for the ingest of, and it may not even be for the data entry part of it. That's basically for reviewing all the information, making sure that everything was coded correctly, and then generating the materials that the town treasurer needs to print checks. Sunderland is one example of a town that uses the services of the COG for that, and they have an accountant that works about 10 to 12 hours per day, I'm sorry, per week, and Sunderland pays the $48 to $55 per hour for that position because of the overhead that the COG charges. So,
how does How do we as a town compare to the school department?
In terms of how they do data?
In terms of what the hourly rate for accountants they have?
I don't have that information. I don't know. I would have to go back and look at the school's budget, determine how many staff people they have in the business department, and...
Yeah. Or we could give Patty a call or something in the morning.
Absolutely. Definitely. She would have the information. I'm sorry, I don't know.
Okay, and so this is the first step towards what? What, if anything, do you see this changing how we think about the FY17 budget, and then what should we be starting to think about what this may do to an FY18 budget or to a broader overview of the classification schedule?
I think you touched on the two most important things. This is, for the most part, these results, first of all, they're preliminary. Second of all, they're definitely not anything I want to act on for the most part in FY17. Definitely, I think it's something that we need to look at in terms of the overall examination of our staffing, what the people in town do and how they're compensated. The only thing that I would and that I expect to act on, and the recommendation that I'll make to this committee as well as to the Board of Selectmen, is to significantly change the compensation for our town accountant, to bring it somewhere up, even close to in line with some of the other similar positions in our area.
Did we do a comparable job description as far as responsibilities in that, Doug, also?
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay.
That's something that Kat actually spent a good deal of time on the phone with the folks in Greenfield, the folks at the COG, and that's how she was able to determine that the difference between a simple data entry clerk versus someone who actually makes judgments on finances for any given town, she was able to discern that the differences in rates. The COG, for someone who is paying more than a data entry clerk, they're paying $30 to $36 an hour, depending on who it is and what they're doing, mm-hmm. For proper accounting work.
Are they benefited?
Yes, fully.
They are?
What's the top of the salary schedule for that position?
For what?
$28.85. She's a grade 5. I'm sorry, yeah, grade 5.
Grade 5. And step
right now, she's a step 3. She's been with the town for about 2.5 years.
Okay.
I'm recommending a significant increase to her step, because without going through a full review, a reclassification of the job, that's all we can do. So,
and do we like as I guess one question? So this is an in-house survey. How does this compare with the contracted survey that
at this point this is far more comprehensive?
Okay.
Believe it or not, we haven't gotten finished results from the contracted survey.
Okay. And when we get, are we going to wait to get those before taking any actions, or how do we feel about that information and when we might get it?
I broadly speaking, the results of that survey will definitely be able to speak to all of the other departments, all of the other positions. And I would certainly recommend waiting for those results, getting some sense as to what that says about, you know, where our classification and compensation is for town positions. For the accountant, I don't want to wait.
Okay.
I really don't.
So you're going to make a recommendation that the personnel committee, personnel board, take some action.
Correct. This will be going to the personnel committee at their next meeting, which I think is in early April. It's going to the Board of Selectmen tomorrow night, and it's here before you. So,
I'd just like to make one comment on this. The comment is, if you look at all the pays that they've designated on this paper, there are a lot more mores than lesses. I've said for years that the town of Deerfield employees are very well compensated, and for the most part, they are. You may find one occasionally here or there, like, for example, the senior outreach coordinator. Don't even know what it is.
We don't have one.
It's a grant-funded position that's unfilled right now, so it doesn't even...
So it doesn't make any difference,
meanwhile,
we're saying it's $275 less.
Correct.
Whoopee-dee.
Right, yeah.
So to me, I wouldn't worry about it. My only concern would be about the town accountant. Everybody else seems to be making more. And when you have assistant, library assistants making $1.90 less, that's not bad, because they all still fall within the range. That's my only comment.
So right now, just so I have all these numbers correct, so right now for that position, we're at 23.24. Step three.
23-24, current fiscal year, yes.
Okay, and the range or target of the hourly rate you'd be looking to get that into is?
Step seven, which would bring it up to 26-44.
Okay, so how do we think about the fact that the position
26-44.
Will get there organically? You know, like should, how do we feel about, and again, taking away from the specific situation, if we have a step 10 person, we might be paying more than average for something. If we have a low step person, we might be paying less than average for something. Isn't that the way that should be? Assuming
absolutely.
The average employee
absolutely.
Is a step five on average or something.
Forgive me for not being clear. This is just a stopgap measure to ensure that our accountant continues to work for the town of Deerfield. My expectation is that this position will go before the personnel board for review and reclassification.
Okay. And you say that because there's been initiation of person wanting to go work somewhere else? Or, I mean, this just came in.
I say that because I am aware of the skills and abilities of the individual in that position.
Sure.
I'm aware of the scope of responsibilities for that position.
Yep.
And I am aware of what other people doing that kind of work are getting compensated in our area. Boston, no. Didn't look there. But Worcester, forget it. Hartford, no. Springfield, no. We didn't even look at Northampton mm-hmm. or Amherst. We're looking just in Franklin County. And we are underpaying this position by a great measure.
Were you comparing, like, step one to step one and other counties?
Yes. Actually, Kat made very clear that she was looking for the range of salaries in each of the towns that she was able to get information from. She wasn't interested in what one person was being paid that day or that month or that year. Mm-hmm. She was looking at the range for salaries. For data entry for the COG, it's something like 20 to 26. For accountant, it's 30 to 37.
But again, towns aren't using 30 hours of that service per week.
No, this is the COG, the employer, that
right.
is employing the person at full time.
Right, but for a town that's utilizing that service?
For the town that's utilizing that service, they're paying anywhere from 48 to 55 an hour.
For
because they're paying the overhead of the COG.
Sure.
Yeah, so.
Okay.
So I figure even rolling in benefits with the position that we have, we're still not anywhere near $48 an hour. If we roll in benefits, we're closer to about 36.
Sounds pretty good. Okay. Doug, do you know if the South County EMS guys are en route or...
They were expected to be here. They could be that they were expecting to start the meeting at 7. I don't know. But I know that both of them were planning to be here. So
the paper did have it as 7 in the Greenfield Recorder.
Okay.
How does that happen if we post 6:30? Really?
Where is it posted at 7? Oh, really?
Here they come now.
Okay.
The sheet that I just gave you is a printout hot off the presses of the Excel spreadsheet. It's color-coded. The columns with Finance Committee recommendations are color-coded so that if there's a recommendation there that's above what is being asked for, it's marked in yellow. Recommendations that you have that are below what was asked for, they're marked in red. And in some cases, you haven't made a recommendation, so it's also marked in red.
I see.
So that's just a way to track what you've done so far and how it's worked.
Okay. And were you able to take a look at this versus the list I sent you or not?
Yes, that includes all of the numbers that are that you sent to me.
Okay.
So that should be up to date as of your last meeting. Well, as of right now, I guess. So.
Okay. All right. Well, this is very helpful, and.
And it might be a way to go back actually look at some of the numbers that. Where you actually voted a number that's higher than what is in the budget now.
Right.
So you can correct or amend as you see fit.
Okay. Anything else that people want to bring up if we're hopefully going to be able to start with the EMS
question.
Budget in the next few minutes?
How is it posted out front or in the town clerk's office?
It should be posted. It's posted with the agenda that he's got, so it should be posted at 6:30.
It is posted at 6:30
okay.
out there.
Right on the paper that we submitted. It just doesn't find its way, apparently, through
okay.
everywhere else. So
I didn't even know there was a newspaper article.
I didn't either.
Oh.
He said on the website it says 7 o'clock, too.
Yeah.
We find a lot of telephone numbers incorrectly in the paper, too, even though we know they were given correctly. Yeah, you did.
Yeah, we're seeing that's unfortunately not correct, but...
You're correct, they're wrong.
This is... No, I just don't wait until it's South County.
Okay.
I'm going to pass this out. It deals with South County, but discuss it when everybody else is here. And I probably need to explain it, so...
Thank you.
We got the statement. Why did he do it?
Did you get
four
copies? Yes, three. I'll make a couple more. I thought Jack said he could make it.
I'm pretty sure you're correct. Yes. Okay, great.
While we're waiting, one other thing I'd like to discuss is our meeting schedule over the next, you know, month going into town meeting. Right now, I was planning to have next week's meeting be on Tuesday, the 29th. We'll have Kevin coming in to talk about wastewater treatment, and John Koreski will come in as well to go through all the capital items. So if that works for everybody.
6:30.
Yeah, I think we'll stick with the 6:30. We've been doing that for a while, and that seems to work well.
Wastewater and what?
Capital.
Capital.
All the capital items. Then I'd just do the following Tuesday on the 5th. And then I was hoping we could do the following Monday on the 11th. I actually have a conflict and would not be able to do the 12th.
Okay, so the 29th. And what's the next one?
April 5th.
Tuesday.
Which is Tuesday.
Yep. 6:30. Okay.
April 11th, which is a Monday. And then I thought we would post meetings for both Monday and Tuesday, the 18th and 19th, given that the following Monday is town meeting, just to make sure we had ample time to cover whatever may need to be covered. And if we're done early, then we can just, you know, not have one of those.
April 12th is the date that was scheduled for the pre-town meeting, the presentation with Finance Committee, Board of Selectmen, Town Moderator. We're
okay.
Basically providing information on the town warrants.
Okay. Well, then I guess we wouldn't have been able to meet that night anyway.
No, correct. Right. Okay. But the expectation is that you'll be able to attend.
Okay. Well, I don't think I will be able to, unfortunately.
Hi.
All right. Well, with that, the only one that's, you know, definitely going to be set right now is the 29th, but that was my thought on the rest of the dates. And since Mark is here now, we can move on to the MS budget. Please,
you guys have
join us.
The arena here.
Yes, and there seem to be some mix-ups on the start time. It was posted at 7 at some places, so we've just been backfilling with some other items that we'd start at 6:30, but you didn't know that, so thanks for coming. And
I apologize.
No, not your fault. That was, for some reason, posted on the town website at 7.
I'm sorry, did you just say April 18th? That's a state holiday.
Oh, sorry. So. Okay. Well, then,
not April 18th.
I haven't looked that far ahead yet. So we'll sort that week before the town meeting out when we get a little closer, but I thought it might be helpful to have, you know, an extra meeting in there just in case we needed it. So
we also wanted to get together with the selectmen and go over the budget items.
Right, and I had sent an email to the select board about having a joint meeting the way we had the preliminary one back at the end of last year. I thought that was helpful, and I think they're looking at their schedules and can respond, or I don't know if you guys have discussed it already, if that's something you guys were looking to do.
We discussed it, and we felt it was very valuable as it was done last year, and I think that Doug was going to try to get a consensus of the schedule so that we pick a date.
Great.
Whether it was on your meeting night or our meeting night, it doesn't matter.
Yep. Perfect.
Thank you, sir.
All right, so I think everybody has the updated copies of both the South County EMS Enterprise Fund budget and then also the capital expense budget, just so that we are going off the same information. And, you know, I know we'll probably have a few things to go through, and what I'd like to try to do is to really keep those two parts of the budget separate with, I mean, obviously Mark can articulate how we'd like, but with our questions and what we're looking at. So, you know, to first start with the operating budget and try to stay focused on FY17 operating budget, and then as we get into capital, that will, I'm sure, lead into conversations that go beyond FY17, and then we can have those then, if that works for everyone. So,
other than I would like to go over this, which deals with the FY16 budget, because okay. That does play into FY17.
Okay. Well, whenever you think that that's the good place to do that, we can
start right now.
Well, I'd like to let Mark start. Okay. And, you know, thank you for coming to see us. And sorry, Zach wasn't able to make it too. But if you kind of want to give an overview or whatever intro you'd like, and then we can take it from there.
529.
Forgive me for this is the first time I've sat on this side of the table. So the service is doing very well. The budgets are, I think, have matured through the last year and a half or 2 years of the budgetary process. We've put together what we thought was a road forward with the budget. The committee voted to release some of the money that was in the accrued funds.
Would you speak up? I can't hear you.
I've been told I'm not speaking loud enough, so if somebody missed that, I apologize. Okay. So the committee voted to release some of the monies from the overtures of the last 2 years or year and a half, and keeping the budget the same way it is, but spending that accrued money towards the budget. So the budget doesn't change, just the assessment to the towns will have changed. With the overages that there, we're looking at moving our timetable up 1 year to put an ambulance on in 17, which is a year earlier than we had anticipated. But with the age of our fleet, it's not a surprise. We've been kind of praying that we didn't have any major malfunction breakdowns or anything of that nature. So that's it in a nutshell for where we're going. The budget's staying level at this point in time. We do know that there's going to be reallocations at the end of this fiscal year once we know what it really looks like having a full staff. We're for the first time at what is what we would be considering at this time a full staff. We've put people on partway through last year, and the budgets have got to be adjusted for that.
Okay.
Anything else in particular you're looking for, Chairman?
Well, I guess I'd open it to the committee if people want to start. I guess I'd like to start with the operational budget, but we can kind of take this as it comes. Skip, did you want to?
Yeah, let me just go over this so everybody understands what I attempted to do here. I went through the 2016 budget. So if you look on the left-hand side, those are the numbers that are in the town's budget. Whatever you want to call this thing.
No,
second page. Yeah. Tom, do you have two copies of this by any chance? Bill's missing one.
Yes, what? Bill can share.
Did you have another one there?
We can share.
We can share.
Okay.
Here.
So.
Here, Tom.
Yeah, we do over here.
It's building.
Which one are we talking about?
This one we're talking about right now.
Yeah, we're going to share.
No, we got
no,
one.
No, there isn't. There isn't.
No, all set. Thank you, Tom.
So, for example, director's salary, budgeted $65,000 through the first 18 warrants. We've spent $44,406, leaving a balance of $20,594. I then averaged the expenditure over the warrants, and it was $2,467. I know the number really is $2,500, but this is what it works out to here. So for the total of 26 warrants, we'd end up with $64,142 spent. Pretty straightforward. And then the difference between the budgeted amount and the anticipated expenditure amount is $858 more that would be available. And I did that with every one of the line items. Full-time staff, 59,000 approximately. Call staff, 122,000. These are the dollars that are available or overages in the budget. Medical supplies, where, you know, if we continued our existing expenditure rate, we'd end up expending $3,000 more than was budgeted. And as you go down through all of these, and you get down to the bottom line, we have approximately $250,000 that I would expect to see at this point, at the end of the year, unspent.
So I guess if I can try to maybe summarize, and obviously some of these are small numbers that we probably don't have a lot of questions about, but it seems to kind of boil down to full-time staff, call staff, employee benefits, and then I'll throw in other payroll costs just because that's a fairly large negative. If maybe you guys could speak to to those, and I imagine some of it has to do with as you are adding staff and kind of ramping up.
Yeah, call staff was a fact that basically we had anticipated trying to incentivize having call staff fill opening spaces for a second ambulance, and we tried it for a year plus, and basically it's not worked. Mm-hmm. We had overage last year in that same line item. We've added a second person on the more busy times, or actually a third person, and part of that takes and allows our director to do more directoring type stuff, but be there for the second ambulance to be on call. It's been extremely successful in its first endeavor, but that money that's there will not all be spent, but it's the first step to trying to make sure we have a full-time or a ready, available second ambulance to fulfill the need when the first ambulance goes out, especially during those times of the day when it's proven to be a call type issue. So the call staff is going to be reallocated to that full-time staff, which isn't going to use up all that money at this point in time. The full-time staff, we, as I said, partway through the year, we added two more people. Part of the problem we have with putting on full-time staff is the fact that if they are not paramedics in the local system, they'd have to do ride-alongs until the medical officer releases them. So we have three people on a rig until such time that they're released by Mass General Law, so it's an expense that we have to incur, which mm-hmm. we're not sure where that's going to pan out in the middle of that. What were some of the other big
the benefits and other payroll costs? Or just I'm just looking at the other two that are kind of larger numbers on the spreadsheet.
Benefits, employee benefits was what was projected by the town of Deerfield for the benefits. It's been readjusted for next year and the budget. It lowered it down.
Well, I suspect if you look right underneath that, you've got a negative $30,000, potential negative $30,000, and someplace between the two of those, where it says other payroll costs as opposed to employee benefits. I'm not sure that there might not be some of that that should be in the employee benefits section.
Yeah.
Medicare, for example, is one that.
I think the way they're listed is they're actually his way to town of Deerfield, maybe he can help with that. But I think what they did is they combined some of the expenses for the town of Deerfield into that payroll expense. When I look at the sheet here, so this year we're fully funding the Deerfield cost, which is like 50, I believe somewhere around $57,000.
No, but what I was thinking, I think as I understand it, whoever does your payroll handles Medicare.
Correct.
And
correct.
Pays that. And
that's
I think
yep.
That number is reflected in this negative $34,000. I'm guessing.
Yeah.
Someplace in there. And it's
we know that we've had a really hard time with estimating the addition of this system into our bill paying process. And basically, we overshot in one and we undershot in another one. And we didn't know what some of them were until midway through the last budgetary process. So it didn't hit in the last budget. So we're correcting for that. It's a moving target. It's floating in that general area for those items, but we'll balance it out in the third year without any problem at all.
Okay.
I think you're exactly right on that, Skip.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I mean, I think, you know, the explanation on those two makes sense, and the fact that you may still be ramping up your use on the full-time staff as people are coming online makes sense. I guess the only question I have is, are you, given what we've done over the intervening period, are you reconsidering the plans with the call staff and the second ambulance at all now that you do have the director kind of in place? Even if it's not ideal, is that working? Do you anticipate continuing to try to go in this direction with call staff or trying to do something different?
The answer is yes, 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 yes. We're trying to incentivize getting people to take training classes within the towns that we service. And we'll be offering some incentives to have people take the basic EMT type classes if we can't get a class for nothing, but at least give some sort of incentive to have that happen so that we'll have more call staff. But we're finding that what we've done with having the person that floats in those time periods, which it's very busy or our target shot periods of time, has worked out extremely well, especially since we can bring the director on to do his jobs during that period of time so that he's doing a twofer for us. He's covering both the administrative costs and he's also covering for the second ambulance. So I'm anticipating that as we learn this, we will be readjusting it, if not as soon as we know it, but as soon as we prove it. In other words, we have inklings of things that need to be changed, and we talk about them extensively. We have a very good director's report that comes out that keeps us well aware of what we feel are the downfalls and the pitfalls at this point in time, as well as the good things that are happening within the organization. And I can't pass up the opportunity to express what a great job these people are doing, hope that nobody equates the budget with the actual operations of the facility at this point in time. It's a really well-run endeavor at this point in time. So we are going to be to make this short answer there, yes, we're going to be changing as we see it needs to be, as we have in the past, right along.
Okay. So you think you have a lot better perspective on that, say, a year from now, as you've
absolutely
got all your full-time staff in?
I think we'll basically nail the budget. And again, what comes into play is the one unknown at this point in time is what we're going to do for housing.
Right.
We've, on the recommendation of Tom and concurrence by the administrative assistant, we're going to go for RFP for housing. So that we can evaluate the best conditions for the ambulance service to do the best job it possibly can for its district, so to speak.
Okay.
So that's our big unknown at this point in time.
Skip, I guess before you jump, do you have anything else on this?
Only thing, if you look, I know last year I said that my analysis indicated that we were going to have, or the ambulance service would end up with a surplus at the end of the year between 400 and 500,000.
Yep.
And everybody sitting on the other side of the table from me was up in arms and said, no, it's going to be 100,000. It's going to be 150,000.
No, I think that you were spot.
Yeah.
Wait, please. I think you were spot on with your analysis. I don't think anybody was willing to take a guess. I don't know if anybody said there would be 100,000. I knew without any reservation whatsoever, we had $166,000 because we had a grant that covered $166,000 of our budget. So we knew that there was money, but we didn't want to take that gamble at that point in time to say that it's this amount or that amount. And there's nothing wrong with us doing a good job and not putting staff on as fast as we could have and spent all the money just because it was in the budget. And we're still very prudent about how we're going to do business, and we want to make sure that we have a sustainable business. So
let me throw out a number for you this year.
Okay.
400,000 surplus.
Okay.
And that includes 50,000 for the ambulance and 50,000 for other capital.
Okay.
But you're going to be sitting on 400,000.
We'll meet at Wolfie's right after we get the cash.
It is a concern, Mark, that we generally speaking, and I think you would be the first one to look askew at any other department in town that did that. So
no, because there's two different reasons between the town's accounts, because basically they can come to you and ask for money anytime they draw a shortfall. We don't have that option. We have to go through three towns.
Oh, that's not true. You do have that option. What you have the option is you have to get three towns to agree to it.
Right, which is not as simple. And basically there are things that we do with Board of Health and other areas in which we allow overages to stay in place for lean times and mean times. So basically we don't balance them. And if you look at the Board of Health budget, it's a seesaw. It goes from really high to really low, and a five-year average is where it needs to go. We don't have a five-year average. Everything else we do on a five-year average, and you're spot on. There's one thing with your calculation I hope you'll look at, is because we've taken $144,000 out of your $400,000 number, so I'd be guesstimating, if I were you, that we're closer to $250,000 left over at the end of next year.
Okay. And actually, while we're on the topic of retained earnings and previous year's budgets, I saw it may have been updated, but there was a usage worksheet for the retained earnings that had the indirect costs. It was $57,898.
Yes.
And what I wasn't, was that for FY15 or 16? And whichever.
FY 16.
That's for 16?
For the year we're in right now.
Okay. And is there a line item for FY 15, or what became of?
We can't legally pay that. The town cannot legally pay that bill unless we actually go to town meeting with a special warrant article just to do that.
Okay.
We can't pay for expenses incurred in a previous fiscal year without.
You can pay it as long as you have a 90% vote to pay it.
Correct.
Bottom line is, we brought the same issue up last year. We asked about it, and we asked that you put it into the budget. And since you had the money, we asked you to pay it. But nobody wanted to pay nothing. And you have $58,000 in next year's budget, not this year.
Well, there's both. There's indirect cost in the budget for FY17. And while it hasn't been done yet, there is money targeted from retained earnings to be used to pay.
No, that's an old sheet.
No, that's a new sheet.
That's a new sheet?
Yes.
My understanding, and please, someone jump in.
I thought they changed that sheet, and that's one of my next questions.
Nope. No, we...
Someone jump in.
That one you had for 2015 on that sheet.
It did say 15. That's why I asked.
I know it did.
Because
okay.
It said FY15.
We can't... It's got to be 16 and 17.
The retained earnings are from FY 2015.
Right.
The certified leftover money from FY15.
I realize that, but it says Deerfield indirect costs FY 2015.
And that's a typo on my part, and I'll take full blame for that, and I apologize for
that. That's fine. That's why I'm asking, so we can sort that out.
That should be for FY 16.
Sure.
Correct.
Right.
I'm sorry.
Not a problem. So then, I guess, going back to the point, so FY 15, we're saying, is...
John is absolutely correct. If we wanted to pay an FY 15 indirect cost, first, we'd have to determine what it was, because it's based on a calculation of expenses. We'd have to go back to the town's appropriations from that year plus the South County EMS budget, because it's a calculation based on those. We would then have to figure out where the money was going to come from, because that would affect...
That's no big deal.
On a rough
from South County EMS.
On a rough calculation, we spent about half of what we did in 16 and 15.
Right, so it would be a lower... Right.
It would be around just under $30,000.
Okay.
And $15,000 we would be paying to the town of Deerfield to the, ourselves. So basically to go back after recouping the $14,000 or $15,000 and going through all the different votes for that, it was... We didn't feel the necessity to chase that money. If that's something that the Finance Committee would like to put before the Board of Selectmen to do, I'm sure we'll it will be accepted with very gracious thought processes.
Tom wants to stick his foot in his mouth. Why don't you let him?
I feel like
And I asked you that same question.
Before the U.S. Senate, my esteemed colleagues.
Well, let's not get carried away here, all right?
No, please, I'm just going to correct you. And it's just your terminology. You said no one wanted to pay it. That is not true. And if you go back to look at any of
our
meetings...
why didn't you pay it?
We just wanted a bill.
Why don't the town print out a bill for $25,000 or $30,000?
That's all you... Just give us... That's all we said. And Bruce, you've been in a lot of our meetings. Didn't we always say that? We just wanted a bill from the town to tell us what we owe South County.
Remember what you said too, Tom? You also added to that. You said, and whatever you do doesn't make any difference because it's not on our schedule, so we're not going to pay it anyway.
No, I never said that.
All right, if I can jump in here.
One thing I do want to clarify, though, is the fact that Sunderland did pay the bill prematurely and paid it up front the first month of our operations.
Okay.
And we didn't know what to do with it, so we had to give it back.
Okay.
So Sunderland has always tried to pay the bills. Whately hasn't been that gracious, but we have been trying to figure this thing out, and it falls on the fact that we didn't figure out that cosmic. We were worried about the bigger picture of getting stuff up and running. So the Board of Oversight should take full responsibility for not chasing it to ground, but it was basically it wasn't the strongest thing that needed to be resolved at the point of time in 2015. So,
and I would tend to agree with you on that. And I think, you know, the formula did not get finalized until December. Did we?
Correct. It was one of the last things that Casey Warren did was to coordinate with the other two town administrators and the Board of Oversight to actually. There were three separate options for the administrative indirect costs, and it took that much time for the three town administrators to work with the consultant to come up with those options, and then for the Board of Oversight to actually say, no, this is the one that makes the most sense,
and
that's what we're sticking with.
Actually, the budget really wants to present it how I would do a budget. I'm used to doing a budget because we combine capital into the whole operating budget thing, which I'm very uncomfortable doing. Typically, we would set aside our capital, so we would be looking specifically at capital expenses.
Versus operation, yeah.
Versus operation, because...
Oh, in the account itself, you mean? Because it's broken out on the budget, but not in your account.
Yes. Last year's budget, it was on the same
together
line.
In one.
Yes.
Okay.
So what would happen is that, so we would talk operating, and then we would talk capital, so we wouldn't get too confused when next year we come in, we're not buying an ambulance next year.
Right.
We're not starting at that higher value. We're starting at that lower value. But what's happening is we're still learning the mechanisms to make the accounts work. And next year we will be presenting a budget different. It'll have a capital aspect to it. It'll have an operating, because we're going to the town. Doug over here is trying to put that into a system where we will see an operating budget and a capital. So it should be easier even next year also.
Okay.
I, there was, at least in this one, there is a capital.
We have it separated, actually.
We did. It's a very, very last-minute addition. We did break out just the ambulance purchase from the operational budget. So the operational budget doesn't show any set-asides for capital reserve or any of that.
Okay.
It just shows the operating expenses. The bottom line is essentially the same.
I'm sure there will be other questions. There's one in here that I looked askew at last year, and then I looked at it, what's been spent out of here this year. It's called liability insurance. $4,000. $4,000 last year, $4,000 this year, $4,000 next year. Nothing spent last year, nothing spent this year. Got any idea what that is? As opposed to the one that's above it, where it says vehicle insurance. So
that is a question, actually. I asked Zach late last week. He was going to be looking into it. And we're trying to get that number solidified and figured out. It could be that it is insurance that's being paid, but it may be being paid out of the wrong line item in the budget. But there is liability insurance that the EMS does pay. So separate from the liability on the vehicles, I think I'm trying to find that.
Mm-hmm.
That's a $26,000, $23,000. That's the workers' comp that I'm thinking of. But there is a liability insurance that
is
should
that $4,000 in line with what it?
It sounds about right. Yeah.
Okay.
What's it cover?
Liability of the service. At least that's my recollection.
As opposed to vehicle.
It's separate from vehicle insurance. It's personal separate from workers' comp.
In case you get sued for giving the wrong medicine.
Okay,
right.
Sure.
I always thought it was selling the cases or something that the beginning of that.
No, you have to have insurance.
Yeah, it's got to be have lots of insurance. So it was one of those things that at $4,000 again, it's not.
Yeah, I mean, I
appreciate we will get an answer, as Doug is saying. We will.
I would assume. What's that?
I wrote it down for you.
Okay. I would assume it's not that you're trying to be self-insured, or I would hope you're not being self-insured with liability.
I don't know of any insurance agents on our board.
Mark, just from an overview look here, I can see that Deerfield's assessment for 2017 would be $314,000. I know that today we have an entirely different ambulance service, and I understand things are going very well. If we were to back up, and I just wasn't involved, so I don't know, but if we went back to the last full year that Deerfield operated its own ambulance service, and I'm not even sure, was that also combined with other towns then, or was, okay, just Deerfield, what was the budget amount to operate the last full year we did it, roughly, off the top of your head?
My estimate was right at $200,000.
$179,000 is the number that sticks in my mind. Yes, yeah, so right in that area.
We calculated it as.
But it was not a paramedic service.
I clarified myself to say that today is completely different. I know that. And I would go on to say that if it was $179,000 versus $314,000, and of course, time and cost have been doing this, and we got to take that into account. But
the differences between maybe skip to my numbers is the fact that I probably put in the capital because we put $25,000 to $35,000 away for a 10-year period to cover the replacement of the ambulance.
Right.
The ambulances now are going to be changed out a little bit more frequently.
Sure. It should be
because of the paramedic. Aspect of it, we're making more miles calls than we were when we were this basic because a lot of it was done with paramedic intercepts and or were not made at all, and we're also covering two different times, so distance is a lot further.
Thank you.
Well, Tom, we can hear without. I think let's keep it over there.
That clarifies where I'm at. I was just curious, just what we used to do and what it covered, and where we are today. There's a big difference, of course, like Mary's pointing out. But you're really talking $200,000 up to $300,000.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, and hopefully it will settle out somewhere.
Who knows?
Between
down the road,
the $200,000 and the $387,000 it was over the last two years assessment.
Mm-hmm.
So somewhere in that grace period, we're hoping that the town of Deerfield has got a full-time paramedic service. And understand, full-time paramedic service is defined by EMS mm-hmm. as having a certain number of hours covered by a paramedic. It's not having somebody there, a paramedic there every single minute of every single day.
Yeah.
But that's our goal,
yep.
is to do that. So just want that terminology clarified also, because...
Is there any plan to do a written summary report and projection of what you see the structure being in the future that each town meeting could actually give out at their annual meeting? I for one don't have a clear vision of where you're going with this service or what the projections of 2 years out or 6 months out or
in terms of staffing and ambulances.
Yeah, staffing, equipment, two ambulances, four ambulances. Well, I'm not sure where it is.
I guess maybe if we could start with a specific part of that question, I think you asked is you mentioned the ambulance and looking to purchase a new one this year.
Right.
Could you talk a little bit about the replacement schedule going forward, which maybe will lead into part of what Bill's asking about?
The replacement schedule, to the best of my knowledge at this point, is projected a 5-year window to replace an ambulance. 5 years.
5 years. For
5 years replacement, to bring a new ambulance online every 5 years.
And how many are you going to run?
Right now, we're running three successfully. I don't see us ever, and I'm not going to say ever, but I don't see us going more than that. And actually, when we first projected, it was going to be two. But the third ambulance has proven to be extremely valuable in doing other services to the high schools and things of that nature where we didn't take our backup offline to be somewhere else. And we are, we're at the tip of the iceberg from my vision. To give you where we'll be 5 years from now, it would be extremely difficult because I really would like to see us offer more services to the towns that we service in the areas of seniors, outreach, doing things in that area, because we have people that are in readiness 24/7, and we're averaging 3 calls a day. So there's a lot of time in which these people can be out with the community doing some outreach. They take the ambulance to come here. They take the ambulances to go to grab something to eat and bring it back to the house. So there's a lot of things that I personally, and not speaking for the Board of Oversight, would love to see us reach out and give benefit to a very large population of our town, both in the school, the very young, the school, the senior populations. I think we have services that we will look at once we get through this first 3 years of trial, and we will be asking ourselves what can we do better and what can we provide without adding a lot of cost to any of the towns which we service. We have right now our second ambulance is beyond its 10-year window, and that's what we're projecting for a useful of an ambulance, because it's going to make an emergency run. That third ambulance is not, something I'd want to drive every day to go 90 miles an hour to a run or any of that nature. It may become some different aspect of the organization that provides services. We don't have a plan for that. If this next one comes offline, it will probably be traded in, which would leave us at three. And again, the last ambulance, the oldest ambulance, is still going to be on that 10-year window. It already, I think, is past that 10-year window of being replaced. So we may very well get back to just two ambulances being replaced on a 10-year cycle. But until we actually, the cost is negligible at this point in time, as you can see by our budgets. It's not a big driver. We may find out that that's a big change as we move through our paces. So that's as best I can give you on that aspect of it.
Sure.
Mark, it always struck me that when you originally were talking to ambulances, it made sense. There's something happening here. You've got another call. I don't see how we could operate with one. But, of course, I look at things very mechanically. And I always kept saying, two ambulances, what if there's a grease and oil job, transmission's gone, there's an accident and something's crunched on one? It just seemed most logical to me that there would have to be a third backup ambulance. It may not have to be top notch, but, you know, and I know there's been a lot of discussion, a lot of heat about this of having three, but I only look at it from that perspective as a backup increase.
One of the scenarios we're working through at this point in time is that our ambulances are not in one house. Mm-hmm. So on one occasion where we had two calls at exactly the same time, we went to get the second ambulance. We're lucky enough to have enough to get to the second ambulance. When we got there, it wouldn't start. Going to the third ambulance was out of the question because basically we had another 8 minutes or 10 minutes to get to an ambulance if it was an emergency. It was non-functional. So basically at that time when the first ambulance was out, the call was made for a paramedic backup to come in from another area. So they got there before we could have even gotten there with the second ambulance anyways. But we're always going to respond and on the consideration of the patients in which we serve. We're not going to do this as a money-saving organization. If that's where we have to go, then I think a lot of the people that are here would be looking to find another employment at this point in time. They're looking for the best EMS service that can be provided for the tools that we have available to us. If somebody has trouble hearing me, just either cup your ear or throw something at me. I apologize.
Okay, we're going to get you a headset for the next one. You can walk around.
A clip mic or something, yeah.
Just going back to the backup, though, it just seems so critical. In our business, of course, we had molds, and a particular mold might cost $200,000 or $300,000. And you couldn't just have a spare one, but we were making medical products, and we had to run 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, and if something broke, serious trouble.
Right.
All we could do there is have backup components, and we may have those little pins at $8,000 a piece on the shelf. At least there was a backup plan. So I always saw the third ambulance as...
Well, it's proven very, very, very beneficial.
Mark, I guess I see it the other side, and I, you know, with everything you said, Ralph, you know, I respect what you said, but I'm struggling with a third ambulance, to be honest with you, at the cost and everything. And I understand.
Before you go on,
you're providing a service and a solid service for the three towns. There's no question about it. But once again, I guess I'm looking at it from a taxpayer's standpoint, where there's got to be a limit, whether it's the schools, the town highway, the ambulance service. There's got to be a limit at some point. I understand everybody wants the best. There's no question about it. We all do in life. We want the best. But there's a reality check, too, as far as what we all can afford. And, you know, as far as trying to justify a third ambulance, in my own mind, I am struggling. Because it's not just the ambulance cost, but it's also the medical supplies you have to have for it and so on and so forth. So there is cost-related issues there with the budget. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing. I understand what your goals are and what you're trying to do, but I hope you understand that for a lot of taxpayers, it's also a situation of what can people afford. And I guess that's what I'm struggling with a little bit. I understand the third ambulance. I understand why. But as you just said, you know, there is a thing that we relied on for years before, mutual aid. And, you know, does that affect response time some? Yeah, if worst case scenario, maybe it does once in a while. Hopefully it doesn't. You had mentioned two calls a day in that, and you know, with three ambulances, is it being a little overdone? And I see your vision as far as trying to do some outreach programs in that. Well, hopefully we could do those anyways, even if we only had two ambulances compared to three. So I guess I'm struggling with that a little bit. I respect what you've said before. That's not
no.
That's
I want to focus down on your concerns, because if you're having the concerns, then other people are probably having the same concerns.
Yeah, they are, Mark.
Okay, but the negligible cost of having the other vehicles standing there, even with the medical requirements, and again, they're kept inside, so the equipment is needed.
Right.
Is basically not on our radar as a big item. I liken it to the same thing with our police department, where basically we have a number of vehicles on the road, and we don't take a vehicle that's still functional and get $1,500 for it, because that $1,500 we'll get out of it in using it somewhere else, applying it to a different department, or using it to go to court, or using it to not pay expenses for other things until such time that it is not valuable to the taxpayers to keep it online. We don't have the information that maybe you have, because you have the yanks about having that, but we don't see it as a dollar value that is on the negative side of the curve of what we're trying to achieve. And that's why I said, when Bill asked the question, we scheduled two, we evaluated whether the third one would give us a valuable component to the system, and we tried it, and it worked out, to the best of our knowledge at this point, very well for us. And again, it's only in those onesie-twosies issues. And right now, in putting everything together, it made sense not to get rid of an ambulance in case the system did not pan out.
Well, if we're doing a five-year schedule, though, as far as a replacement schedule, we shouldn't be running into some of these issues that we're having now with 10, 12-year-old ambulances.
Correct.
If you've got a five-year-old ambulance,
yep,
that darn thing better start when you need it. But it also brings me back to Skip's point, the whole budget and that of you know, you're saying level funded, but basically carrying over around $400,000. You know, that.
Did you redo the math so that the money that we're taking out this year, the $144,000,
are you going to be taking that same dollar amount out next year, too?
Pardon?
Are you going to be taking that same dollar amount out next year?
When we get through the budget, we'll know.
$144,000 are you taking out?
Pardon?
What 140-something thousand are you taking
out? The reason
out?
That the allocations went down, and we're talking about the town of Deerfield's budget, and basically went from 387,000
yep,
to $314,000, which is $70,000, and you multiply it by two, because basically we took it out for the other two towns. We don't just do it for the town of Deerfield. It comes out of our budget across the board.
So
so it comes out to...
You're talking about the money that...
was left over from...
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We took our retained earnings and put it towards there. So...
Okay. It's here, but I...
And again, just so that I can give the other towns their...
So, do you have, if you're going to roll an ambulance every 5 years, are you going to do within your budget a reserve against that? So,
yes.
Okay, so each town has 20%.
We had $51,000 going into a budget every single year, and basically with the extra retained earnings at this point in time, we thought it was good because of the age of the other two ambulances to rotate in one a little bit earlier.
So there
earlier.
Will be no big blurps there.
Yeah. And, the fact of the matter is that from an ambulance standpoint, if you're going to replace them every 5 years, it actually doesn't matter if you have two or three. You're still replacing one every five years.
That is correct.
The difference is that you're going to have an ambulance 10 to 15 years old, which is the third one, which we think is okay, in terms of, you know, the feedback I'm getting. So I think that the point on this issue, and Jeff did raise, is what does this mean about other related costs to having that ambulance, to staffing for how many ambulances? And again, these aren't binary good, bad things. It's, this is the sort of, I guess, vision.
This is where I'd like to jump in, because I was going to try to make the point. Jeff has a good point about the taxpayer, and I'm very concerned. Always have been. Mm-hmm. But so I don't want to misrepresent myself. When I talk about a third ambulance, they have three right now. They're going to buy a new one. That would be four. So you ditch the worst, you still have three. What I'm thinking of is a backup piece of equipment. It's not going to be staffed. There's not going to be three sets of people with three ambulances. It's just a machine that's registered, certified. Even the stuff, you know, let's say one of the better ambulances is in an accident. It's going to be tied up for 3 weeks in the shop.
But Ralph, that's not really how it's been presented to date.
Well, you know more than I do, but that's fine. If it's presented differently, then I'm glad I'm talking, because I would think the third ambulance is strictly that back. It's a spare tire, so to speak. Well, you're telling me you know they're staffing three.
No, I don't. Oh, okay. What I'm saying is I think last year there was a fair amount of uncertainty about, look, and this isn't a pejorative comment on you running it so much as you are getting started up and you are trying to figure out how to get up to the level of staffing and service that you're trying to get to. So I understand that that is a process. And my only point to Ralph, I guess, is that that's some of the clarity that would make me more comfortable with certain things just being mechanical backups versus what is the size and scope of the service.
Well, that's why I wanted to jump in, right, Jeff, because I mean, very kind of low-cost back.
Let me try to get some of that, because, again, we talked this amongst ourselves at our meetings that cover this to a degree. Right now, we're only going to staff an ambulance, and it's fair ambulance.
Behind you.
Right now we're staffing for a single ambulance and a backup to cover that need.
Right.
We bring people on for special events, which pays for anything that happens with that second or the third ambulance, whichever one happens to go out. Mm-hmm. The medicine that we have to have now in three different ambulances, we have to have them because they're in three different locations, and we cannot grab a bag off of something that's broken and drag it down to another ambulance. When they're in the same house,
right,
we can take it out of the ambulance and it can go into, you know, that med will be locked in a place and brought to the ambulance, and basically it will reduce the amount of potential equipment needed to do that functionality, because there'll always be that ambulance and you can actually transfer a box with the meds and whatever needed to that area.
Okay.
But the ambulance, when they came to us, were fully stacked or fully supplied with the stuff that needed to meet the mass regulations for a basic rig. So the cost is just rotating over and replacing, and we replace all our stock as we use it. Mm-hmm. And that's usually, hopefully, paid for by the people that use it. There is no intention to ever have a second crew fully on, unless the times get really bad and we end up having, you know, 1,500 calls, or we have to adjust with whatever is thrown our way.
Right.
Bigger fear is the fact that everybody gets really, really healthy and we don't have any calls and we've got another budget to explain the other way. It's good for everybody else, but it's not good for the viability of the ambulance service. So it can go either way.
It comes down to population changes and incident.
As the school systems get smaller, so does the populations in the town. So basically we can have fewer calls, and we may be going a different direction.
Right. And could you talk a little bit about the decision to move the purchase up to this year from the original target of next year?
Strictly,
was there a particular incident or thing, or is this just an organic conversation that led to this?
It was an organic conversation. Basically, it was actually the the culmination of people a lot smarter than I am that thought about, we've got the money now, we can return it to the townspeople, or we can invest it in an ambulance. Both of our ambulances, our spare ambulances, are outside of that cycle of being replaced anyways.
I'm sorry, I don't have it. Do you have the ages of the three ambulances right now, at least roughly? Or
roughly, I think they're 12 and
17.
17.
16 or 17.
Sorry, so it's 12, 12, and 17?
No, one's 8,
12,
and 16 or 17 is a guesstimate.
That's fine. Yep. So
they're all getting up there.
So we did well. Mm-hmm. We can get onto our time schedule this year versus we were planning on doing it in the following budget year, not this fiscal year, but it will be out of.
Right. And so sources for that. So the estimated amount is 250 roughly.
Right.
And there's the 50,000 from FY15, the 50,000 for FY16, there'd be the 50,000 for FY17. Yep. And then the other 100,000 is coming from the retained earnings.
Actually, the way it's scoped out, and this is final details worked out with Zach, the entire cost of the ambulance, including the box and chassis, plus the purchase of equipment needed to outfit it, to upgrade it, is about $285,000. The proposal is to use retained earnings to pay for the entire ambulance. Further, I want to be really cautious in saying this because it's not a guarantee, but Zach and Kat Dolan, who's the assistant in the selectman's office, are going to be pursuing a USDA rural development grant, which may pay for a portion of that.
Okay.
And if that is the case, then the cost to the towns would be far less, possibly half.
Since we're talking about it, it was one of the areas that I did want to discuss. Do we really need the $250,000 ambulance, or is the $200,000 or $175,000 ambulance, which would be what Sunderland has, adequate?
We asked the same question from the Board of Oversight. Basically, the rig that we got in Deerfield was a international top-of-the-line type of vehicle. The one that they've scoped out is a F 550 or 450 rig, which is more in line with what is the standard replacement rig for most organizations. We are slightly different than, you know, a Rescue Inc. or a Medcare or somebody of those natures, because they are able to move vehicles in and out of the fleet to be a first line as they prove themselves. We do not want to go to the bottom of the line and end up with something that we're going to regret 2 years earlier than its replacement cycle. So we still want to stay with something that's in the above average, but not the top of the line. And that's what they've assured me that they're looking at is, and basically the $250,000 rig we bought 8 years ago, I assume that it's not $250,000 anymore. So without doing the due diligence of actually making the phone calls myself and trusting the people doing the job, I tend to agree or think they're probably on spot for the amount of money. The $280,000, I was looking more at $244,000. But again, technology and a couple of life-saving pieces of equipment we have over the last 2 years have cost more than I think the first ambulance that I spotted in Deerfield in 1972. So just some of the equipment that we're putting on is more expensive than the vehicles we used to buy back then. So I have to adjust with the times on that.
Being this type of vehicle, do these come with better warranties than an average truck, or is it just pretty much what a...
It depends on how hungry the auto industry is at the time. We've bought them in the past years with 100,000-mile, you know, bumper-to-bumper type of things. And depending on the given year and how many pieces of equipment they've got sitting on the lot, they may or may not offer those. It's very flexible. It's very fluid.
I didn't know if they were specially built that would afford them a longer warranty.
Well, the ones that we, as I said, we're looking at not just a
bottom line,
something that you'd throw in and hope you got a good one out of it, because you could, you know, they can scope it out to just be a transport, you know, between hospitals. They make a lot of money on transporting things. It could be that little box car you see now from Medcare that picks up and does most of the shuttling. But we've got to, it's got to be a multi-usable. We don't have five or six different rugs on. We've got one rig that's first line, and it's got to cover everything that we possibly could throw at it.
How many miles on that eight-year-old one?
I have no idea. Got me on that one.
You'd be replaced, I mean, getting rid of the 16-year-old and keeping the 8 and the 12.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so the 12 would go into the third?
Third slot and so forth. And if, you know, I don't want to commit them to anything, because it may be the point where they can get more money for trading in two and getting one, and we've proven our operation system to work with just two. That's next year's conversation. This year we're working on getting the budget straight and getting things working well. So, and manning has been the biggest hurdle for us to overcome at this point in time. And I think
always that the issue.
I think we've done a very good job, and I'm very happy with the responses, both the response time and the number of calls and the fact that we have 13 of our paramedics up for life-saving awards for 2015. So,
Do you review our insurance recovery rates versus other regions of New England? Or
yes,
we're right on par.
We're above.
Actually, I was surprised Skip hadn't asked that question yet, because one of the numbers that is probably overlooked is the revenue that we receive. And I think this year we are looking at $400,000, or we budget like $375,000, $400,000, that range. Right now we're collecting, what, we have $500,000?
We're on target to be over $500,000 by the end of the fiscal year.
So, and that's way above projected, what was projected in the original study.
But we brought in $500,000 last year as well.
Yeah, we're doing exceptionally well with our we're returning.
Just so you understand, last year we came in at 480-ish, 500,000. We projected 387 or 390, which is right about what our budget is. We met it halfway in between as to what our guess was for this particular year. We're now, if the projections hold, which I hope they don't, because basically that means people got sick. But if our projections hold true, as Tom was saying, it's going to be over 500,000. We'll be recalibrating it again when we get it next year, and you'll see those numbers go up marginally. And again, understand that my biggest fear is having to come back to the town and say we don't have enough money, because then it's the other side of the coin. I don't want to. The people doing this job deserve to be taken at face value of what they're doing, and having a bad mark for that is not what they deserve. So we're trying really hard, being prudent and consistent, and hopefully we'll be always adjusting up and making the numbers match.
Can I ask you a question about your payroll?
Sure.
How much are you going up this year, percentage-wise?
For
like 1.7%, 2%?
The raises that will go...
Or is it just step raises?
Just the step raises.
Just step raises.
They're going to do exactly what Deerfield's doing.
Same thing?
Same thing. Deerfield manages their personnel costs and everything else. It raises. Everything is done under our bylaws.
All right. What's the scoop on Zach's salary? Because I noticed that he was hired year and a half ago for $60,000, now he's getting $65,000. Then he got a bonus for $2,000. Now he's up to $70,000. I think that's a little excessive.
Well, we lowballed him when we brought him on quite a bit. Basically, we didn't put him at where he belonged to be for the services. I can't tell you what step and grade he would fit into on our assessment in accordance with our personnel bylaws, but I think he's pretty much at that.
One of the main things that you hire a person for like that is a budget. Now, if he's over $400,000 and $500,000 on a budget, on $1.1 million, you're paying for the OJT. That on-the-job training, you shouldn't be paying him a real high rate when he's learning the job.
That's why we brought him in very low. And that's why when we assessed what he did, determined it was necessary for him to get a bonus to equal out
what the performance was done. What did he get the bonus for?
What did he get a bonus for?
Yeah.
Work performed.
Like what? Yeah.
The
reason I asked that, Mark, is I was a selectman for 18 years, and I never gave anybody a bonus in 18 years. And all of a sudden, it's like we're playing Santa Claus to people and just giving them money away. We don't do that. When somebody hires, you hire them, they hire them with a certain idea that this is their range, this is what they're going to get, and you let them work it. And then next year, give them a raise if you have to. That's what we've always done.
That's exactly what we did. We gave him a raise to a level in which he was performing at, and that was through the evaluation process.
Mark, does he get overtime?
Pardon?
Does he get overtime?
No.
And he's doing two jobs, basically.
Three jobs, really. He was doing, and that brings back part of the conversation. I stayed out of that aspect of it, so I will get some answers from you if Tom will write it down, because I'll forget before the meeting's over with.
Tom, you need a pen. Or a sharp pencil.
I've been writing.
But basically, he was doing, he's managing three facilities where he should be managing one. His office isn't where he's located, where the rest of the facilities are. He was putting together the budgets, putting together all the capital aspects of it. He was doing a startup organization. And basically, he was—he did a very good job.
But to me, that's a normal job.
What do you see?
The Board of Oversight disagreed with you, and I have to side with them. I apologize.
What do you see going forward for Zach's position? So you brought him in, we've brought him up. Do you feel like you're in a good place now? Do you still feel like you need to go up or down from here?
We're having internal discussions about that. There are some people that are on both sides of the camp as to whether to keep him in Jack's realm or to look at another increase in his pay salary.
What do you think? I know you're not the entire board, but...
Mine is that we have to come to the personnel board to go anywhere further than is gone at this point in time. I feel we acted within the realm of what the Board of Oversight needed to do, and I think the next ones are we're looking at a better look at what is the job description, how has it changed, what's it doing. We have to evaluate what is this is Mark Gilmore's opinion, not the board's opinion,
right.
We have to evaluate the position. We have to make sure that we're paying fair market value, because I feel that, like our police department, we train very good people and have very good results for them, and they tend to go someplace else because they can make more money. We'd like to retain as many of our people as we can, but we don't want to hold them back, because we want them to be as good as they possibly can be. So it's a balancing game in that realm.
What do you have for education and training programs? The reason I ask that is, like, before, when we would hire a police officer, we'd send the police officer for training. It'd take him 14 weeks to get through his school. And then he'd have to sign a contract with the town of Deerfield that he would give us at least 2 or 3 years of service after he completed the police training. Do you have the same type of program?
No.
Or EMTs?
No, not at this point in time.
Okay.
The people that we've selected, and that's probably one of Zach's strong points, is he gets a very enthusiastic people that want to stay in the local area, and they've proven to be a great asset. We've had our ups and downs. I'm not going to say that it's all been a dream or a cakewalk, but we've the requirements for training are...
Team colleague would like to speak.
Was your question specifically about Zach's qualification or about the people we hire?
People we hire.
People you hire now.
No, that's a very good question, because...
What do you think I asked it for?
Well, sometimes you amaze me. But
give him the microphone, Tom.
Get him on record.
And Skip, I hope you understand what I'm about to say. When we first started, we started with four paramedics and four EMTs on the service. And we thought that was a good mix because we still had paramedics that were, Sunland had an EMT, Deerfield had a couple, two or three EMTs. They weren't all paramedics. And we felt that having the four paramedics and four EMTs were a good mix. But you know what we found is, and when we're hiring now, the EMTs, that Deerfield EMTs, are now almost uniformly all paramedics, or they're working very close to that, reaching that paramedic.
They're on the right now.
And the fact is, the difference between a police officer and a paramedic, which I would never have known, except now be on the Board of Oversight, if you go and do your training for your police, you know, you do your academy training, each department has its own, you know, where you ride around with the staff and everything, where you ride around with a senior patrol officer, then after whatever the amount of time is, they kind of send you out. Paramedics don't work like that. Not only do you have to be, you pass a test to become a paramedic, but because you have that paramedic license doesn't allow you to ride in an ambulance as a paramedic until you have proven proficiencies in each of the levels that a paramedic has to use. So if you haven't gone out, if you haven't been on a cardiac, or you haven't given meds, and you have to go out, and then someone has to sign off, so you could, typically, you could ride for 6 months, Mark, is that about right, or longer, before you can actually ride as a full paramedic, and I never realized that. You just can't, once you get that paramedic pinned on your thing, you just don't go work as a paramedic. So we're trying to hire paramedics now, but we're still promoting the EMTs that we have to become paramedics, because we're counting on those. We feel homegrown EMTs that become paramedic are going to stay with us because they're going to appreciate that we invested the time and effort into them. So it is a little different.
And that's good, and that's what I would like to see. But if we're going to do that, how much do you have to invest in schooling for them? And the schooling that you're investing, are they doing it on their own time, or are they doing it on company time?
I don't have that. I don't, Mark, do you have an answer? I don't have that answer.
How much does it cost?
I'm confident that basically these people are doing it on their dime, because we don't have a line item for education in there.
Yeah, you do. $27,000.
But that's just...
Well, that's why I'm asking what it's...
That's just to keep the... your certifications current.
Well, you got recertifications, which is $6,250.
So your question was who pays and when are they paying?
And how much are we paying?
All right.
And what are we paying?
And do we get any agreement or written contract saying, if I spend $5,000 to get you educated, to get a paramedic level, are you going to guarantee to give me 3 years back service before you leave?
I'm pretty sure that that's not the case, that we're paying for them to get their certification. The thing about it is they do get time to study because of the number of runs that we make. They can always squeeze in a couple of hours of studying without too much trouble. The contract itself hasn't proven to be necessary at this point. We did that for Deerfield 10 or 12 years ago because basically we were getting them through the school.
We were taking them through school and then they were just leaving 6 months later.
Yeah, 2 months or 3 months they were leaving. So it was done to protect our assets of putting them through school. The ambulance service has not had any experiences of that nature at this point in time.
Yeah, education, training.
Yeah, 17,000.
Did you find the other line items?
17,000 for education.
17,000
total.
Plus 40.
It went from 20. 7 to 17. That's one of the reasons I was concerned.
Well, I assume that, and you know, just so that we can maybe get the facts straight. When we started the organization, we had 3 paramedics and 3 basics, and now with full paramedic staff, the research are much greater than they were with basics, and it went from 3 to 9.
Isn't that for the ready the company that does the schooling, does all the?
I think Zach said he may have contracted one service to do a number of
right,
things.
Right, but I'm not sure whether it's a 17 or the 7 or.
No, so they come in and they do all the, they maintain all the currencies, all the CPRs and.
And they keep all the records so that basically we'd have no liability with anybody making a run that shouldn't be making a run.
So that's not for like
Taking
a paramedic class. That's for training to maintain currency and all the things that the paramedics and EMTs have to say.
I just see a category which just says education training. That's going from 7,000 to 17. So I just want to know.
Nope. Yep. That's maybe all. We could have Zach follow up on that one because
we'll follow up on the thing that he's got done. But again, it was
somebody in the back that wants to ask a question too.
Just a question as far as this budget and the human factor. And correct me if I'm mistaken, but it sounds like I know the original presentation to the town was one paramedic and one EMT. Per shift for the ambulance. Now it sounds from what I just heard that we're hiring EMTs, we're training them to be paramedics and we're upping their scale. So it sounds like the budget for labor is going to go up when they're all paramedics again. Is that what I'm hearing at this point?
Yeah, the budget will go up because it'll be in a different classification. But the actual budget, because again, we still use paramedics, basics and intermediates to fill out the roster. We have to have a paramedic on to make it a paramedic rig. The cost of adding that extra paramedic at this point in time is offset by what we used to call the line item that we had for call staff, because we can't schedule call staff people. They just don't want to do an overnight shift or because what we were doing was paying a stipend to have people to cover us in second ambulance. So we took money from that account and brought it into this, and basically it offset it, and our line items are correct with the amount of money it's costing us. But yes, it's going to go up with paramedics, more paramedics on service.
So the difference between the basic and the paramedic level quite a few $1,000s? Per person?
Per year, yes. I would hope so. You have almost a bachelor's degree of education difference between the two of them, and mass certification. It's
so we're heading down the road for a full paramedic service.
We are a full paramedic service. That was the agreement, that we'd be there in 3 years.
Okay.
The basic pay for a EMT at the maximum time is a little less than $40,000 a year. The basic pay at the max time again for intermediate is about $50,000 a year. And then the top pay for a paramedic for a year is about $60,000 a year.
Yep.
So the difference is going from basically 40 to 60, $20,000 more.
So
now you've got a scale in between there for intermediate, so that's like halfway
in
between.
Yeah, it's scaled between there is, they branch through them, and they overlap a little bit. The basic can make a little bit more than a basic or beginning intermediate, and so it's a economy of scale for what the market will bear.
So Mark, right now in this budget, the full-time staff and call staff salaries total about $590,000. So putting Zach aside and putting benefits and other things aside, just salary. As you think about what your target is of where you're trying to get to in terms of numbers and qualifications or certifications and the salary schedule that we have right now, how much is that?
Well, with the exception of one paramedic, excuse me, one paramedic annual salary. You add that on, and they said $60,000. You add $60,000 because that's what we're looking at. We added last year's budget versus this year's budget. We added two paramedics in mid-year. So basically, you're going to add that on to, and now we're fully staffed.
Okay, but and this is where I'm trying to understand, because you haven't been fully staffed, so the budgets aren't matching the usage of those line items. So what I'm trying to say, if you start over, now you have your roster, and now you have your qualifications, and now you have your salaries, what does that total? Is it at less than or more than $590,000, which is the current budget of where you're trying to get to from a budget standpoint? 590 is the full-time staff salary plus the call-time staff salary.
I've got a question.
Sure.
I might be able to bring some light onto that. If you take nine paramedics that they propose to have,
okay,
I'm 60,000.
Okay.
540,000.
Okay.
Plus all the time.
Yeah, but
that would mean all nine paramedics would have to fill every single shift.
Yep.
So it's and that would also mean that nine paramedics are getting paid at E3.
I'm just saying
step 10, which is also not the case.
So it should be less than five.
What they're looking at is nine paramedics, probably somewhere in the middle of the scale. I mean, purely in terms of averages. Nine paramedics, paramedic level, middle of the scale, making about $50,000 a year, plus probably another $80,000 to $100,000 to pay for per diem on call and those expenses to fill out the rest of the shifts. That brings you up to about $590,000, not including the drivers. So.
No, it doesn't. You said nine people at $50,000 plus $80,000 to $100,000. That's back to the $540,000.
$540,000, $550,000.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I'm trying to get to is, okay, once we're at cruising altitude, what are we talking about? And that's the answer.
This budget is, and again, we have people forecasting where we're going to be and how we're going to do it, but the end of this fiscal year coming up, when all is said and done, with the exception of where we live, it's going to be pretty crunch the numbers and we know where we're going to be at.
So could you go over those? I know that when we started talking about this, you know, 3 or 4 years ago, we had a model that was proposed, and we had been operating under, and I guess I'm hearing from you that that model hasn't worked.
Correct.
That there is some changes that you're putting in. So what does the staffing look like for both first line ambulance and the backup? How's that going to work?
Well, the first line ambulance is going to be paramedic staffed.
Okay.
And the backup is going to be right now a full-time paramedic floating between those periods of time which have the greatest call need for an ambulance.
That being Zach or somebody else?
Well, it could be Zach or it could be somebody else. It, for the most part, it's going to be Zach because basically it allows us to take advantage of the fact that he's doing administrative work, which he can squeeze in the time, but be there in case we need it as a backup paramedic. So for our needs, it would be much better for him to do it, but I assume that with the assistant director being appointed, that I assume that there's going to be training and things of that nature that will be outreach stuff that will come on the dockets.
I'm sorry, who's the assistant director? Or what is... I guess I didn't mean the person, but how does that integrate with the number? He will be one of the nine paramedics and then will also be the assistant director?
No, he will be, yes. He's part of the nine.
Okay, perfect.
The fantastic nine. But I assume his duties will take up some of those things which will allow for the overlap for Zach and him, so that basically they will be that third person to fill those needs of that crunch time, so to speak. Again, we're hoping to reinvigorate the call staff to do some work.
Did you find a mega property and casualty group? $9,600?
Well, before you do that, I'm still not, before you go on to something else. So, as I understand it, we're going to have people, the first line ambulance will be staffed with full-time 40-hour a week positions.
Two paramedics.
What?
Did you say two on a shift or one?
There's two people, one guaranteed, one paramedic.
Okay.
So it may be two paramedics and maybe one, yes, one.
Could be one and one.
Could be one and one, could be whatever. If we were lucky enough to have two paramedics there to make all the calls, then we'd pay a lot more money.
And the second, the backup ambulance, what's the staffing look like on that?
What they found is that 85% of our calls, have you heard this before?
No, go ahead.
Okay. 85% of our calls come between the hours of 10 a and 6 p, which I thought was amazing that it would be 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. To me, that I would thought it would be much different. But when they looked at the numbers, they found out they came between 10 a and 6 p. So what we've done is we brought in a paramedic, a second paramedic, that is there between 10 a to 6 p.
Now, does that include, is that 7 days a week, or is there a breakdown in
that?
Yeah,
and what happens is that guy that comes in is usually a per diem hire. That guy will go out on the call. Our full-time paramedic will stay back, and he will take the next second ambulance. So our second ambulance will be staffed with a paramedic between 10 a and 6 p. And we've found that we've been able to hit more of our calls by a much better percentage by having it staffed between the 10 a and 6 p.
And not terribly important, but I'm curious why you send out the per diem guy first rather than the full-time guy first.
And that's a good question also. What it does is it makes sure that person's currency stays. Again, because we're talking, and Zach as well would answer this question much better than I can, Dylan. But they figure that person goes out, maintains his currency, maintains his familiarity with the equipment that's on the ambulances, and so they stay active on the ambulances, and so they rather have them. That
makes sense.
That's the primary reason. The secondary reason is if we keep our Zach or AJ back here, they can do administrative work that may not get done.
Okay.
So the per diem ones, are you pulling those out of Amherst or Northampton fire
anywhere
departments?
We can get them.
Wherever. Okay.
Anywhere. Is anyone that
any of the paramedics that are fit our medical demand or medical doctors' requirements. In other words, you can be in Coulee Dick and not have qualifications to be run out of Deerfield because of basically your medical control officer has to sanction you being on the rig, and until they sign off, you can't use your license for that as a paramedic. You can run as a basic, but you...
And Zach knows that one of his special police officers is a paramedic?
Yes. He was also one.
Yeah.
So.
Did you have a question?
Yeah, what is the Mega Property and Casualty Group? $9,600.
I have it correctly named. A couple of years ago, the town had the insurance under Mega, M-E-G-A, which is an insurer. That line item is for, I want to say it's another liability line insurance item. I don't know exactly what it covers, but...
Mary, can you help us with
this one? Is that just general liability for the service?
They get one bill, and then they break it out for the different right. departments according to the percentage that it involves.
Right.
Sometimes it's workman comp. Sometimes it's a liability insurance.
But they have different lines for a workers' comp.
Insurer. Yeah.
They have a $23,200 line for workers' comp.
That's
and they
separate.
Have workers' comp contingency, another $1,800. I don't understand that.
So maybe someone could follow up with us on that line item?
The 23.
Unless somebody knows right now.
The $2,300 workers' comp, or $23,200.
Yep.
That's workers' compensation insurance. That reflects the amount of money that Barb is assessing the service. Zach believes that number needs to be higher. Therefore, we put in a contingency. The $23,200 directly translates to Barb's workers' comp line. The $1,800 is allowance in case the number is higher, which is what Zach believes. And that was part of the reconciliation of trying to make those two things work.
Okay, I think we were asking about the $9,600, though.
Right? Correct. That's that, and I was looking for the, I believe that's the share of the general insurance that is being paid. Although I could be wrong on that.
And there's another one from medical insurance contingency, another $14,600.
That was, again, that was
the... On top of the medical insurance, are $35,400.
Again, the $35,400 is the amount that Barb will be assessing South County EMS. That's her calculation of what they pay or need to pay for insurance for their staff right now, their health insurance. The additional monies, the $14,600 is the additional that Zach wants to budget for based on his predictions of what the insurance will be in FY17.
And
so that's where that is.
Right. And as I've said previously, I do not like having different amounts between Barbara and the different offset. I think that whatever they decide, I don't really care so long as they agree. I do appreciate that as you guys are still having people come online, I'm a little bit more lenient about that in a very short-term nature, but this is something that I really think needs to get dialed in next year. Like, we need to be at a point. I know it's just an estimate anyway. It's not going to be right, whether it's Barb or you guys or whoever else guessing, or not guessing, but estimating. But, you know, this is one that I think it's better than we did it last year, but I would very much like to see these contingencies go away next year.
If no question. The thing that we need to keep in mind is what happens this year with hitting those marks. If we guessed right and we get the money in place there, then we may continue it for another year so that basically we're not caught shorthanded.
Well, the thing is, to me, that's what retained earnings are for, right? That's why I do think you guys should have some cushion, just like a town has free cash, for unexpected things that occur and then need to be incorporated into the subsequent year's budget. That's kind of where I come out on that.
Yeah, we're working on trying to come up with a number that works.
Okay.
The problem is it's an enterprise fund. If they go over on a budget, if they exceed their appropriation because everybody chose the Cadillac health insurance policy, Zach can't come to the finance committee and just get a transfer.
Agree, and that's for me.
It has to go to a town meeting. They don't have the authority. They don't have the authority to appropriate. It has to go before town meeting.
The point is that we have, our town meeting is at the end of April. Our town meetings are basically at the end of April.
Sure.
By the time we finish with our town meetings, we still have closing in on 20% of the year left. So we will know in April at town meeting whether or not we need to tap the reserve or the retained earnings to cover costs. If last year we were sitting with, I'm just going to throw out the number, $400,000 surplus, we're looking at giving, give or take, approximately the same thing this year. I question the budgeting, and that's what I'm doing, is I'm questioning, I doubt the validity of the budget. And I would rather have you guys tighten up the budget if we're sitting on hundreds of thousands of dollars in retained earnings.
Well, maybe it'd be helpful then to do a quick walkthrough, retained earnings, where we are, things that we do know are coming through, because I don't think the number's that big. I mean, I think that there's a conversation to be had. I just did some really kind of quick math, and I think a lot of other people have these numbers, so please correct me. Looking at the 500,000, I'm going to use round numbers here, 500,000 FY15 certified retained earnings that we're starting with, about 90,000 of that is capital, right?
Mm-hmm. There's no such thing as capital. It's just all retained.
Okay.
Fine.
But the point
allocated,
is
budgeted as capital, right? So let's just.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
You can't.
What do you mean, I can't what?
There's no such thing as a capital allocation in this budget. The intention was to set it aside and to save money for an ambulance or for equipment.
Okay.
But it's $502,000 of retained earnings.
Okay.
Period.
So for Dylan's hypothetical pretend retained earnings, can I call it capital?
Sure.
Why not?
Great.
So next year, though, you won't be able to do that, right?
The expectation is that at special town meeting, probably in the fall, after the certification of retained earnings from FY16, that we will then go through the process of establishing the capital reserve fund, the capital stabilization fund for South County EMS, and seed it using some of the retained earnings from FY16. Yes.
Okay. So before we go back to this, quick question back for you guys: do you have a number that you intend to move over to that capital stabilization fund at that time, or do we not know yet?
I assume we're going to move back everything that would be just the $90,000 at this point.
You will have just expended $285,000 on an ambulance if all goes well, maybe less if all goes better than well.
Yeah.
You will have outfitted that ambulance with all the equipment that it needs, and Zach has finished, you know, and will have still have a little bit of monies in a reserve for extraordinary expenses. I would say that you'd probably be able to put away the $110,000 that you have been setting aside in the previous 2 years and use that to seed a capital stabilization budget.
Yeah. Which shouldn't it just be, like, if I think about there's two things going to capital, and if like that's time zero next fall after we've bought an ambulance, we now should have zero for ambulance reserve because we just bought one, and we're going to put aside 50 grand a year for 5 years and then buy the next one, right? And so the only thing that would be seeded in there would be whatever medical supply, I forget what they call it, the other capital item that you've had, whatever you feel that amount seeded has been or has been saved up, which again was 40,000 roughly as of FY15, because 50 of the 90 was the ambulance, so 40 from then plus whatever you don't use from your FY16 budget. So I would think that number would be somewhere between 40 and 80,000.
What about the 50,000 for the FY17 budget?
For the ambulance, that's going towards
not setting aside
buying
the ambulance.
That for the ambulance. $50,000 for medical equipment.
That's not being appropriated. That's not being requested or appropriated in this budget.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Isn't there a special town meeting in an article for the
$57,000 for FY16 administrative and direct costs?
Well,
that comes out of
right.
retained earnings of $502,000. Correct.
Okay. So, sorry. So going back to your question and away from the capital account that will be created in the fall, so we had 500 minus 90 from the pretend capital balance, so you're at 410. Yep. Then, as the gentleman in the back said, now taking out, let's call it 60, just to keep using round numbers, for indirect costs for FY16, so now you're at 350. And then from the budget, I see another 60 being used to fund the FY17 budget to lower the assessment costs. So now you're at 290.
144.
I'm sorry?
144,000.
What's 144,000?
That's what you're mixing two things. Let's.
Okay, I'm sorry. So is the 60,000 just the Deerfield portion of the amount being used?
Yeah.
Okay. So then let's call it 150. So again, stick with round numbers. So 150, that would take you down to 200,000. Right? Is that, am I missing any big things? Is that generally?
Anything else?
So 90,000 is not being taken out.
Right.
Which 90,000, I'm sorry?
285,000.
Okay, so there's 200,000 after doing that math, and then there's still the ambulance to be paid for. Now there'll be 150 in the ambulance. I guess the one question I have is I'm not sure why you wouldn't use the 150 from the ambulance reserve and then whatever else from retained earnings.
I
know it's the same thing.
It's that statement that we don't have it in reserve. It's all retained earnings. It is coming from that number.
Sure.
And it took a while to get my head around it. It's coming from that number, but that number doesn't exist, so it can't come from there.
So it's coming
from the big picture.
So the purpose of the numbers that we're going through, again, taking out 90 for the capital that's not capital, 60 for the indirect costs, 150 roughly for the budget reduction, and then 100, which is basically the additional amount you'd have to come up with beyond the 150 that's set aside, would leave you with 100,000 in retained earnings. That's what I would say.
What about the 400,000 in retained earnings that's going to go in this year?
Well, that's my next question is, okay, that plus whatever increases or decreases you guys would estimate or think, would it come from FY16 total operations?
Plus any additional revenue that we
earned,
that we have beyond, calculated.
Right.
So if we go, and again, what we do in Sunderland, we always look at, and Mary, this may sound familiar to you, probably do some in Sunderland, we use five-year averaging. So we look at what we get for, like on local receipts, what we get for 5 years, and we start putting the number together. Mm-hmm. So it's always a little bit lower than what, but it gives us a little fudge factor in case something happens. We're not quite at that 5 years. So I would assume this year we're looking at 410. Probably next year, if we still stay over the 500,000, we'll probably bump it up to maybe 450 next year.
Right.
And get those numbers a little bit closer. So that would shrink up also.
So when FY16 certified retained earnings are calculated, and assuming that you do the things we're talking about doing with the ambulance, what do you think that number will be?
What will certified retained earnings in September of 2016?
Right.
Because you're not actually going to spend anything this year, are you? Between now and July 1st.
I'm assuming we're taking out all the ambulance and things that we're talking about doing. Timing-wise, maybe it doesn't, but...
Okay, well, just for that number. So right. Basically, so that Skip feels really good with that, there's $400,000 that we're planning, we have a plan for.
Right.
We have $100,000 we don't have a plan for, is the way you're looking at it.
Right.
And now we're looking at having a certain amount of money being put back into the pot by overages,
right,
and expenditures and everything, right, else. My gut instinct is the fact that we're going to have pretty close to $250,000 left.
Total. Okay.
After you take all those expenditures,
so that there'll be about 150 added on from the course of FY16 operations. Yeah. If you want to,
and that to me is a, I think it's pretty close to where it's going to be. I think.
So, what do you anticipate the retained earnings is going to be after we finish with the 2016 budget?
400,000 to 500,000.
No, according to Skip's estimates right
budget,
here,
it'll be the return earnings from 2016. You're already up to about 400,000. Now you got an extra income coming in.
How do you get 400,000?
Because he's taken the numbers that is set aside in retained earnings now, that doesn't take out the ambulance, doesn't take out all the other things in which we're going to spend.
Okay, fair enough. So
take a look at the back of Skip's thing.
I am looking
at the
back.
$356,000 right there, plus the money coming in from the ambulance receipts.
Okay.
That's going to be $450,000 to $500,000.
Plus the $500,000 that's there now, call it $900,000. Then deduct from that these figures here.
Right.
So Skip, you're thinking they'll end up around 500,000 versus the 250 that Mark just gave us after ambulance replacement and these other things that are
400 to 500.
400 to 500.
I agree with him.
It sounds like last year.
It sounds like last year, exactly. Although last year, I knew what the numbers were. So, and even though he said
the 500,000 was
everybody came in with $100,000, I knew exactly.
You're a little high.
Yeah,
you can. But.
Last year I was low, so this year I'm authorized to be high.
Someplace between the 250 and 400.
Okay, how do you think about what that number comfortably, but also responsibly, should be? How do you feel about
it? My gut feeling is we should have $100,000 going into a...
reserve.
Capital reserve, no, a capital...
Operational
reserve fund to guard us against that kind of thing. And that basically we should be building our capital depending on what we see in the next 5 years, which for us is a total unknown for housing. So that's the reason I've been hoarding money, is the fact that if we built a building or we did something, we needed something to bond or to whatever we were going to do, because we don't have a set
plan as to what the ambulance is going to, and it's right. vitally important for this organization, from what everybody's been telling me, and I come from an older era, my EMT experiences were
nothing like today. You're talking about the older era. You're talking to the wrong group of people here.
No.
The exception of Dylan, we're older than you are.
If you would listen carefully, I said
I just had to get there.
The older era of EMS, my numbers and what I used to do are not comparative to what we're doing in EMS today. So I'm riding the curve of understanding and trying to learn at the same time everybody else is. But we need an operational reserve. We need a capital reserve for things that might break or that's unanticipated in some of those other areas. And then whatever it costs to replace the time-sensitive equipment, a long-term capital plan, stabilization, whatever you want to call it, we need to be sinking money into that. Just like from my other hat, the town of Deerfield, needs to be putting money into a capital stabilization fund so that when we get hit something like the school, we're not looking at how the heck we're going to pay for $3 million to fix something. But the total number, I'm comfortable with $200,000. I don't have a problem with that. And that, if I was coming from the town's point of view with this size budget, I would be closer to $150,000 to $160,000. But there are some things that are not the same as normal town departments with running an ambulance service.
Let me throw something out. Now, I can appreciate the reserve. It's a matter or question of how large that reserve is. For the schools, we talk about an E&D fund.
3 to 5%.
Which is set by the state at a maximum of 5%. Mm-hmm. I would have no problem with 5%. Mm-hmm. But we're talking for that 5% of the budget would be $1.2 million, 5% of that $60,000, not $500,000.
Nobody's proposing $500,000 as a reserve.
Could you speak to, you mentioned an operational reserve. Now, you're talking, the purpose of the operational reserve is exactly what, and I'm asking only because I've gotten a couple different answers, not from you, but from different people. So could you clarify the scenario of using the operational reserve?
We've been lucky and not had to actually tap that very much, but my guesstimate, and again, we're 2 years into running an ambulance service. We don't have any history of 5 years out planning or that. My guesstimate would be loss of a piece of equipment. It got burned up in a fire because they went in and set the piece of equipment down there. We had to replace it. It might get replaced. We might get, and we would go looking for insurances. That's why we have so many insurances in place to replace it. But they're not going to replace it the next day when we need it. They're going to replace it when it's just things like that. And again, 5 years from now, our capital, our operating budget may be 5%, might be less, because time says we don't have any of those things. And what we've created in this organization is something that is totally unique in a municipal ambulance service in more than one town.
Okay.
So,
I would say when I skip, I'm looking at your numbers. What I would say is there's two things that I'm uncomfortable with, and that is what we're projecting for expenses for the full time staff and the call staff. If you take those two things out, the rest of the budget is pretty more or less where it needs to go, and over time you can correct that. I would say we have to at some point we have to correct the call staff and the full-time staffing numbers to make those closer. And to tell you the truth, those are typically call staff. I mean, when we do our police and fire and highway and whatever in town, those are pretty simple numbers to calculate out. Typically, we're just not. And I would say that your biggest change is going to be in that call staff. We really took our conversation to the towns through town meeting about having those two paramedics or to be able to put out two, you know, the backup, the regular and the backup.
we took that, we've taken that very seriously. I don't know, to tell you the truth, I don't know if the way we have the call staff, I think Zach's solution to add just put a member between 10A and 6P, we're saving a whole bunch of money doing that, and we're covering the runs.
If you've got 85% of your calls
85%.
Coming in, then, I mean,
right. So
I can't argue with those numbers.
But I think what I would say over the next year or two, that's where we're gonna tighten up. We're gonna tighten up those numbers, and I still think we're going by the original Baxter went, you know, that the study that we had done. I'm uncomfortable. Look, I'm a selectman. I've been a selectman for many years. I have a whole. A political statement. I have a whole big problem that Frontier took $250,000 out of their E&D and applied it to the budget, because what do you do next year if that $250,000 doesn't get applied to the budget? We're all going to be in a world of hurt. So
we'd probably take the $250,000 that they will have in excess this year and put it back.
Well, it's funny you mention that, because one of my next questions would be, you guys are using $140,000 out of retained earnings to the budget, and how do you feel about that?
Where is the $140,000 figure coming from?
Well, I was told that was the number that was being applied from retained earnings. All I see is Deerfield's portion at 60.
Look at the button. No, that is not Deerfield's portion. That is the amount of retained earnings that is being used.
Okay, well,
yeah.
Okay, that's what I said earlier, and I was told that
we're
wrong.
Wait a minute.
And I'll tell you what my thought process was on that. I had a problem, because again, I have a problem with taking the money from the E&D. The reason that I was convinced to use that money, I'm going to say 140, whatever the number is, I was convinced to use that is when I started to look at the money that was coming back, that what we were hitting our numbers with on the revenue. And when Zach told me that we're over 500,000, we're very easily going to go over 500,000, then I felt comfortable that we could do that 140,000, 144,000 and apply it. Because we would have it at least one more year until we could pay that.
Thank you.
So that's how I felt about that.
Okay. And is that something that you would like to get that number to zero, so you're not using retained earnings for operations? And Doug, thank you for correcting
that.
No, I
did not.
I think over time I'd rather get it to zero. But if we, in my view, if we have retained earnings, yeah, it should come back. And
absolutely.
Just like we use free cash in our town, if we know for us, we know we add like $150,000 to $175,000 every year in free cash. So we have a free cash use policy that says, okay, we're figuring we're going to have this, so we kind of dictate where that money goes because we know it's going to be there.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather, on a service like this, I'd rather not have a lot of extra, so I'd rather get that down to zero.
Mm-hmm.
But if we see we're continually having that $100,000 excess, yeah, put it in there and use that as a revenue source. Absolutely.
One of the things that I'd like to ask you guys to do is to take a look at the salaries, probably in full-time salaries, and see how much overtime money that we're using. I've got a concern that we're using. There's a fair amount of overtime. And it would seem that we ought to be able to find a way around the overtime.
My gut feeling, and I can't attest to it 100%, is the fact that when we were down two people, we used a lot of overtime. We've restructured and we've set the budget, set the manning such that overtime should be a minimal, but the issues you have is people who call out. And when we have per diem people on, they can be held over on a shift, and we have to fill the shift in lieu of them being held over at their primary job or at some other job. So we're, with per diem, we're the, you know, the stepchild.
I agree.
That should have cut tremendously in this year of any overtime that's there, but it's the nature of the beast. We have people that have sick time and vacation time and everything like everybody else, but it's not like my job where if I'm not there, so what? I can do it the next day. Someone has to be there, and it's not a luxury.
But my hope is that we can use per diem people to fill those or you've got somebody on vacation, you know that person's on vacation. And
that's our first choice. And basically, we're hoping that that gets better because we didn't have enough per diem people to fill, our paramedics to fill all the shifts in which we wanted, and we just couldn't get people to take them. We hear your concerns and we agree with you wholeheartedly on that aspect of it. I would like to go back just one second because the $900,000 numbers that have been thrown around here is money that's being left over or being spent. We have a budget that stayed pretty much the same for the last 2 years for all intents and purposes, and going in the third year, it's going to be reduced by, and whether it's $140,000 or $70,000, I'm confused, but I thought I knew coming into the room that basically we were going to reduce our budget by $140,000, which meant a savings of our budget, which took it from $386,000 to $314,000, which makes sense that that's our portion of a bigger number, but bar that as a side note to the conversation, our budgets are been at this mark. The first year we did a half a year for all intents and purposes. We didn't get up staffed as far as we did. The second year we only staffed to six people, and we had $160,000 worth of grant money that was thrown in the middle of our budget. So basically it added some unknowns into the process of budgeting. We've now taken full staff, and last year our return earnings was that $500,000 minus what I understand to be about $80,000 for monies that we didn't pay out that we should have paid out. So we're sitting pretty close to $420,000 that we should have been billed and should have paid out.
I'm sorry, what does that 80 represent?
The money that we didn't pay to the town of Deerfield.
The first, yeah. 57.
Well, then we had some benefit costs that weren't paid out either, right, which came to about $80,000 that we had to pay back to the town of Deerfield.
Yep. So where does that 30 or whatever that other number is show
up? We paid that because we were billed for it. We were paid for it. We weren't billed for the $51,000 or $57,000. We were billed for that, so we paid it. And okay, it came out of that number. But it was double dipping because we had to pay for it again this year with the same numbers. But we were able to pay it because we were billed.
Okay. So it's in the existing budget, the 2016 budget.
16?
Which?
You talk
the extra benefits money. But anyways,
I'd like to know where it is.
Yeah.
Where it was taken from.
It was taken from the budget year. This budget year, beginning of this
current
budget
year. So it's got to be out of this budget.
I'm not sure about the extra 30 that you're talking about.
It was $28,000. Well, I'll look into it. But anyways, let's stick with the 50. So we don't get caught up in the short strokes here. We have $51,000 that basically wasn't scheduled and paying out of this year's. But if you took all of those variables out of there, which is basically we had not full-time paramedics, moving to full-time paramedics, going from 6 to 8, not having any grant money to offset anything, and basically those numbers on that $500,000 brought us down to almost $250,000 in that last year's budget cycle. Because basically if we had to pay the $160,000 in grants and we had to pay $50,000, basically that's $210,000, basically takes us down to $300,000 if you use the 500 or whichever number you want to pick there. But basically you have between $250,000 and $300,000 that would have been extra left over in that budget, and that includes 100, well, whatever the extra number we got for extra billing, which was above and beyond what we budgeted.
Mm-hmm.
So that included that. So our budget was, without that variable, was pretty close to a quarter of a million dollars, because we had about $50,000 in extra money. That was a number I predicted last year going in. Now this year, I've got all of those things in the reverse. I have full-time people. I'm paying my bills. I'm lucky enough to still have the revenue coming in, but I don't see us getting a lot more money than the 250 we had this past year when we balance it out. Matter of fact, I see us being considerably less because we have two full-time paramedics on that we're not filling with per diem. We're going to pay more for benefits for them. We're going to pay more for the educational components for them. I have a hard time stretching my imagination to get to $500,000 or $900,000 in money that is not earmarked for something that's going to make this service work the way it's supposed to work.
Okay, I'm not sure where the 900 number's coming from, so I'm just going to ignore that.
I'll tell you
where the 900 comes. It comes from the 500 that we have this year.
Okay.
Plus at least 400,000 next year. That's 900,000.
Okay. But, you know, a number of the certain amounts of the 500 we've already discussed are set aside to go to specific places for specific things. So that's fine as a gross number.
We have not spent those monies, nor have we allocated those monies. You may want to allocate those monies, but
I haven't seen the town administrative fees. That's 57,000 less that they'll have.
Well, and I'm looking through the your expenses, and you're talking about salaries. Right now, you're spending between $14,000 and $15,000 a pay period. I go back to September, and you've got $16,000 and $17,000 pay period expenditures. You're not really spending any more money now than you were last fall. On a biweekly basis, $14,000 to $15,000.
Okay.
And so, you know, when I go through the analysis and try to come up with what we're likely to spend for the rest of the year, it's based on what you've spent in the early part of the year. And, you know, if there's something in these numbers that you don't agree with, I'd really like you to tell me specifically what it is.
I budget differently than you do. And my numbers have proven out to be, as I just tried to explain, pretty accurate to what...
You know, Mark, last year I said 400 to 500,000, that it came in at 502. So don't tell me about your numbers.
All right, hold on.
I'm not going to hold on.
The point of this meeting is try to be productive and to focus on the budget. Now, there's a very clear way to talk about the number last year as 500 and ignore some of the other things that are on this sheet. And there's another way to talk about it as 250, including some of the things on this sheet. So I think not all, but some of the disconnect is coming from the way that we're talking about the number itself, not the way it was budgeted or spent. Cool. Now, I will say on Skip's behalf here, reinforce a point he made. Last year from the conversations we had, I would have expected to see expense numbers for recent months from, you know, the last couple of months more in line with the way that you talked about the budget a year ago, coming towards this year, and now here we are a year later, and now it's going to be next year. Now, it's not that I have a problem with you not spending more money than you said you were going to, but the trajectory of the expenses on salaries isn't really lining up with the pace that you said it would go, or if it's not there yet, how it's going to get to a higher level from here if a lot of these people are already brought in. So that is one point that I'd love.
Let me ask you a different way.
Sure.
And I'm very happy that I've been educated by those numbers over the last 6 month period of time, but I don't have a crystal ball, and I can't tell you that what we did with bringing the ninth person on would cut our budget by $2,000 plus the full-time people, if he's correct. If his numbers are correct, what we've done in the last 6 months has decreased our budget for personnel by his numbers by $2,000 a pay period. I'm happy. I don't know why. I can't explain it to you because basically I just got the numbers now and I'll go look into them. But those numbers, projected-wise, bringing another person on and paying benefits should have taken the cost of manning up, the way I do mathematics, So if he's right and we have under $350,000 left over this year, then as Tom has said, they'll go back to the towns. But it'd be something that's proven more than just a short period of time. Out of a six-month window or even a year-and-a-half window of time, it will be proven on a bigger schedule of what we do here in Deerfield, which is over a period of time we take an average. We don't have any averages. We're trying the best we can to come up with numbers that work.
I know, but you know, there's only so much of budgeting that prudent budgeting that should or can be backward-looking. There's a certain extent which you need to use the past to try to project the future, because that's the whole point of
Absolutely.
What we're doing here. And
yep.
So for me, you know, the fact that the projections are not mapping out, it doesn't mean that you guys can't run a service, but it does mean, okay, well, what is different? What was unanticipated? How do we think about that for next year? And, you know, the answer this year is a little bit similar to last year of, okay, well, next year we'll figure it out. And again, I understand you're still kind of growing into the service, so I get that.
Well, let me answer your question, because I think you answered it with the same pieces of the puzzle that are on the table, is the fact that if we changed our model to do away with call personnel and bringing a ninth person on, and we've realized a savings in the last 6 months, looking forward, is nothing we could have put in place that would have told us that was going to happen. So the only way I'm going to learn from that is with Skip's insight that he's got from looking backwards for 6 months, and us evaluate what really caused that. I'm giving you a guess that if what he's presenting to us is accurate, and I he's been accurate with his numbers, I'm not complaining anything about that. It's just where we put him in buckets that kind of are different between us. But if what he's doing is correct, and we're realizing that much in savings because of what we did with the ninth person on, then we just check and adjust. But that's in this year's budget. That's in this year's period of time for us to review. We'll get into that nitty-gritty. You're just doing it ahead of us because we're still running the ambulance service. The budgeted items, the numbers...
That's kind of a little bit of a loaded statement.
Go ahead, take your shot. It's okay.
No, I mean, you know, I understand that there's a lot of focus and effort, and it's not easy to run an ambulance service, and there's many people involved with the operations, but I think part of the job of the Board of Oversight is to also manage around the budget of that operation. So I don't think saying we're too busy running it is really
looking forward, we're looking at running the ambulance. We're not too busy to do the budget. We've done the budget. We put together a budget we think works. And I guess you can take the shots at us for not being as conservative as you'd like us to be, but we're in there every single month, every single period of time, looking at this, trying to figure out how to do what we're doing,
right,
and learning in the process.
I'll say I think that the preparation and the presentation of the budget this year is vastly improved from last year. And like you said, a lot of that does come from the fact you have another year of data. Doesn't mean we agree on everything right now, but I think we're in a much better place than we were after our, you know, couple hour meeting last year, mm-hmm, as I recall.
Yep.
So I do recognize that.
This year.
Right. Right.
I have a question if you're set. I see a line item in here as far as Skim's rent for a little over $50,000.
Yep.
But in the budget, I don't see anything for permanent housing as far as where does that come into play? Are there going to be expenses as far as, you know, we've talked about, are we going to leave it where there's going to be ambulances in three different locations? Or, you know, we've talked about, I've heard, you know, permanent housing. If there's going to be permanent housing, where is it allowed for in the budget here? I don't see any monies allowed for that.
Can I ask one? And that's a great question, something we should talk about. Can we try to cover any non-housing things and then end with that if people think that's a good idea?
Because
I think that is a
fine
kind of a topic that many people may want to talk about. Do people have any other questions on these budgets before we proceed to the topic Jeff raised about housing and plans for the op?
Just out of interest, when you meet monthly with Zach, does he have a separate line item that you track for overtime expenditures? Or
No.
I don't believe so.
No.
Okay. We can get the numbers.
That information can be gotten. It is tracked probably through the payroll records, but it's not tracked inside the budgeting system.
Okay. Because, no, I'm just thinking in the current, in the following year, you want to track that down as you track employment numbers up, I would think. Yeah. Right.
Well, we can track it out. It's just one of those things, and I didn't mean to be flippant in saying we don't have time to deal with the budget because we spend a lot of time on the budget.
Right.
But we haven't gotten that as a precursor for us to chase. And and by Skip doing his digging, his due diligence, it's opened our eyes to have that as a target item on the report out from the ambulance service.
Thanks.
We're looking at really making calls and things of that nature, which, and again, not taken away from budgets, it's the part we have to make sustainable first.
Right.
Under SCEMS recertifications, for membership dues, you had $500 2 years ago, nothing this year, and it's going up to $5,500. Explain that. That's under SCEMS recertifications, there's membership and dues. For 2015, it was $500. For 2016, it was zero. And then it went to $5,500. On page two.
Is it recertification
top of
the
page,
three?
About four or five lines down.
You have to recertify all three.
SCEMS recertifications, membership dues.
I believe, if I may interject, that may be a typo. And I'm only saying that because I'm comparing it to actually the sheet that Skip handed out under recertification.
Well, let's go with Skip because he's accurate.
Well, there's a special line item for recertification, but the only thing it says is recertification, so I'm sure.
Yeah, it says $5,000 for budget.
Correct.
And it's nothing spent on it.
Right. Actually, as of this year, $3,825 has been spent out of that $5,000. I apologize. No, I was looking at the wrong line. Right. I'm sorry. You are correct.
That's what I thought. Thank you.
So, but it was.
So, so not that it's a large.
I'm totally confused.
Okay, so.
Is the recertification the question is, every year?
Zach could answer that. Yeah. We'll write it down.
And my last question is SCEMS intercept fees. I see it's going up from $5,000 to $7,000. How many times, what's it cost for each intercept? Do you have an idea? Is it like $500 or $1,000?
It depends on what the call is for.
And what services.
What services are rendered.
Is there an average call fee like $500 or $1,000? Or?
Well,
see, I don't know. I have no idea.
No, we don't have, there's no average, and it depends on miles loaded and all sorts of stuff.
Well, I see you're going up from $5,000 to $7,000. I'm wondering why we're paying more for intercepts when we should be getting our second ambulance out.
Well, I think that basically we over-budgeted considerably in 15, 16 we went to 5, and I think we're recalibrating between 15 and 5 to 7 is what it looks like to me. But yeah. I'll get you some numbers for that to make sure that it looks like we may have underestimated when we went from 5 to from 15 down to 5, and now we're going back to the mid-range of 7.
Find the midpoint.
Yeah.
All right. That probably makes sense.
Any other questions on this budget other than housing-related topics? Okay. So I guess if we want to pick back, Jeff, if you want to re-ask your question or kind of re-kick off that part of the conversation, maybe we can wrap up with that.
Okay. Just in the line item in the budget here for SCEMS rent is a little over $50,000. You know, we've talked, heard the term permanent housing coming up here. I don't see any line item for, you know, expenses for permanent housing, whatever the case may be. So are we to assume that the ambulance for this coming year is going to be staying in three different locations?
I can answer that question with, no, we're not making that assumption, but we don't know what's going to happen. And I would gladly, and please don't, I'm not trying to be a jerk. I really, but I'm, my articulation skills when it comes to asking this question back to people gets people angry. But I'll gladly put whatever number you want in there for housing that you would like to give to me, anywhere between $20,000 and $1.2 million. And I don't know how we would bond. I don't know how we would do anything in this because we have the hardest time getting any consensus as to how we will be housed.
Housing will be additional to this budget, whatever related expenses it may be?
Not necessarily, because the $50,000 will cover a lot in some budgeting, for some bonding, and some kickoff money.
Okay.
But it doesn't, right. I think that our understanding is that we would have to have a lot of meetings with a lot of people before we made any moves, and I assume that would have to go to decision-making body before that transitioned. And that's, again, if we can't live within our means, we're going to come back and talk to people about what we're doing and why we're doing it. As I started off this meeting, trying to avert that digging of that process, because we really do not know, is that we've gone out to an RFP for housing for us. And I think I can't overstate the importance of getting our units in one house and working out of one house. I think that the benefits, the dividends that we'll get out of having it in one house will be enormous. And we don't see anything else run in this particular way. One of our benchmarks is to get us a place to live that's under one house and can get better organized and have hopefully some of those outreach services that we talked about at no extra cost to the townspeople.
I understand that. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I understand that Island Ambulance is in the process of building a new facility.
Mm-hmm.
Has anybody taken a look or talked with them? I haven't, that's for sure.
I have three different plans for building. I've been to different locations. Rescue Inc. is going mm-hmm. to buy us building a station. Keene's looking at some others. We've looked at them. Basically, it all boils down to where and what's the land availability and where do we go from that aspect of it. So we're not in the building business, so we're trying to get a good thought process going, and I think that Tom's recommendation for going out for RFP is the best place to start, because then we don't take on any real liability. We have people coming to us telling us what they'll give us and within our purview of what we want for services, and we're just going to put a stake in the ground and say that please come tell us what you can do for us.
Could you let us know?
I did not check with Highland. I will, though. I did not know they were going to build another ambulance service.
I just heard about it a couple of weeks ago. I don't know anybody else has heard about it.
Who?
Highland. Up in Goshen.
I haven't heard anything.
Just to ask you a question. You guys ask a lot of questions, but what would you, as a finance committee, think about the ambulance building the building? Would it be better for the ambulance system to build a building, or would it be better for a town to build a building for us? How would that work?
I don't think you can build a building.
You can always build it and lease it back to us.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. Who's the you?
Well, no.
Who's the you in this conversation?
I changed that to I don't think, quote, the ambulance service. I think it has to be one of the towns.
Yes, yes.
That's
fine. And I agree that for us, it would be almost next to impossible for us. There's probably to do it, but I just find it to be very, very difficult for that to happen.
And I do, have sympathy. I do understand when Mark, or Matt rather, says, we looked at it and it's $4 million. And I understand exactly what he's saying, and we obviously aren't going to, at least I don't think, we're going to spend $4 million for, at least not in the next couple of years, for an ambulance facility. That's why I was curious. How is
Highland doing it?
Well, I can tell you that the buildings...
They are a 502c corporation, so that's a different situation for them.
Yeah, but I can assure you that the numbers are all over the place for working the deal, depending on who, what is sympathetic to what you're doing. And $4 million is not a number that I heard, but just to do the building portion of it, I've heard $1.2 to $1.8 million. And again, that's if everything goes well for you. So, and even at that number, somebody's got to come forward and say that they'll do it. And I don't think we have the ability to go out and put those stakes in the ground and do it. So the RFP gives us the ability to have a town tell us they'll build it for us, to anybody that's in the target area that we lay out can do it. We'll be reviewing those as soon as we can get it done, and we put it on a fast track, so it should be fairly shortly that we get the information. But we have nothing to put on that piece of paper, so that's why another reason that I always kept retained earnings as a sacred cow, to not give it back, because at some point in time we may need it, and it's not going anywhere. No matter whether there's $1 million or whether there's $25 in there, it still belongs to the constituents of the towns in which we serve. It's not, it can't evaporate and go somewhere else.
The town of Deerfield has a piece of property adjacent to the fire station.
We're well aware of that.
And, yep. And that's certainly one that I don't know what the selectman's position is, but I'm going to guess that if everybody agreed to it, you would be in favor of using that piece of property for that purpose.
And we offered it up.
I think we are here, too. Yeah.
We offered it up. We just couldn't come up with numbers that made sense to use it. Just to put up the simple building was, you know...
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah, I would see, and that's where we keep on back. If Jack Fisher wanted to knock his house down and build us a building on where his house is now and lease it back to us, I'm fine. See, we don't really care. Our goal really is just to put our people in one location, and
in a target area.
And that's right. And the what the RFP that we're modeling our RFP is for the city of Beverly. City of Beverly had to find housing for two fire trucks and a school bus. I think it was a school bus. And what they did is they went through what their requirements were. They had to have a garage space. They had to have places for the firefighters and bathrooms and all that kind of stuff. Overhead doors. And then what they said is, and they write that all their requirements down in an RFP, and then they put a stake in the ground at the location of the present firehouse or whatever they were storing at, and said that the place had to be within one Google air mile of that position. And that's kind of like us. We really kind of know where our center of mass has been identified. And so now we draw a circle around that, and if we find a place inside that circle, that's the only thing that's important to us. And if it's in Deerfield, that's fine. If it's Whiteley, it's fine. I just know it's probably not going to be in Sunderland, because we're probably on the other side of that circle. But we don't care. We just and if somebody could come up, the only way I see it, if someone, and Dylan may know people who would do this, if someone would say, hey, I'm gonna build a building, I'll give a 10-year, 15-year lease. They could build it on their own privately, not use the prevailing wages, and then offer it back to the ambulance service to use. We could do it that way.
We could buy it off them later on, or the town could buy it off them.
Could be a lease to own or something.
Something.
We could do it that way.
We're open.
Somebody, yeah. But I think if we put the RFP out there, it may stimulate somebody may have an idea to do something like that. But I don't know how else to go. I'll say it again. I thank the South Deerfield Fire District for allowing us, and I talked to one of the members of the Prudential Committee, and I understand. He says, you know, it's not a right place. You know, you got people sitting on the floor, they're just not housing right. And I appreciate their everything they've done to let us where we are right now.
Without them, we couldn't have started, so.
Could I ask what the current lease term in terms of not cost, but date is that we're currently in at the fire station? Like, when is that lease up?
It renews as of 1 July.
Okay.
I believe it's a month to month.
Okay.
No, it's a 3-year, but renews on a annual basis.
Renews on an annual basis, but I'm like, if the EMS were to find new housing as of August,
there's 30-day notice.
And move in. So, yeah, 30-day
okay.
termination. Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Yeah.
I don't know what that is. So.
Essentially, a Tennessee at will.
I can't speak to that one.
Okay. And I have one question not related to this. The capital request for FY17, the capital expense sheet we were given has the total costs of the new ambulance, but that's not the same thing as the FY17 capital request for their budget, right? Like, the is it 51,000 for ambulance reserve and 29,700 for, is it the same as last year for the actual requests?
It is not. The capital request is to purchase an ambulance, $285,000. That's to buy the ambulance and to outfit it.
Right.
To request that appropriation. That appropriation will come, the motion will basically say to make this appropriation out of the retained earnings of South County EMS.
Okay, so there is no money going into the South County EMS fund, and I know it's not capital, but
correct.
Along
no
those
money
lines,
is being set aside only, for capital in
right,
the FY17.
The only
budget.
Request is the operating request.
Correct.
Okay. Thank
correct.
You for clarifying.
That's where the 60,000 of retained earnings being used to offset the FY17 budget is also matched by a reduction in the budget due to no capital request being made this year.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of making that capital request, using the retained earnings to buy the ambulance and to outfit it with the gear that it needs.
Okay. Anyone else have more housing or other questions?
I got one other.
That's the theory.
Please.
Your MOU. Have you been briefed on that, and where do you stand on that in relationship to the fiscal agent? Because I don't understand how all that's going to work.
No.
You want me to take that? Okay. The memorandum of understanding is, of course, the or it's really an intermunicipal agreement, and it's important to use that term. It's the agreement that the three towns signed in November of 2013, I think, back when this hayride started. I think it was 2013. It was finalized around November of 2013, or went into effect at that point. It sets the terms and conditions by which the ambulance service would be staffed, not staffed, but by which the Board of Oversight would be staffed, and all the other details related to it. There are some recommended changes that came from Zach Smith in taking a look at that. I reviewed those changes. They were sent to legal counsel for review. Legal counsel came back with some suggestions. And has offered some advice as to how those changes could be implemented. The key provisions that we're looking at to change are in response to the special town meeting in January, the first being that Deerfield pays 51% or 49% of the bill, but has only equal representation. Deerfield does have a fiscal agent on the Board of Oversight that sits at the table, but is not currently a voting member. The recommendation was to change that so that the fiscal agent was a voting member, becomes a voting member. That would give Deerfield more of a voice at the table, but not an overwhelming voice. It seemed to be a good compromise between responding to the concerns, as well as not turning this into just Deerfield's ambulance service that both Sunderland and Whately also use. There were a few other very minor technical language changes throughout the document, basically making it a little bit more clean when it comes to looking at it. But the other notable change that's being suggested is to remove references to any specific location and instead simply refer to lease or a lease. That's the portion of the intermunicipal agreement that talks about how leasehold improvements, repairs, or furnishings, if you will, are paid for. It basically says that the EMS will pay for any
damage or repairs to their space, but will not pay for any damage or repairs to the shell of the building around their space. So if they rented a building from John Smith Rental, then they would be responsible if there was a, you know, damage to a counter or flooring or trim inside their space, but they would not be responsible for repairing the roof because it's outside of their space. It just defines that so that it protects the three-member towns.
My question specifically comes down to the fiscal agent takes on the hiring, firing, and legal responsibility for the service.
Correct.
I don't think that can legally be done. It has to be done through a town. It can't be done through an individual. And you're saying it's going to be done through an individual.
The fiscal agent
is responsible for the hiring, firing. That can't be done, I don't think. That's why I'm asking.
The term fiscal agent is defined earlier as the town. The fiscal agent is, and that's part of one of the language cleanups, is to make sure that throughout the document, fiscal agent refers to, in this case, the town of Deerfield, as the fiscal agent.
If you wanted to really clean this up, why can't you simply say Deerfield 50% of the vote and Whately and Sunderland split the other 50 any way you want?
That's exactly what should be done. If you're going to go halfway, fix the thing once and for all.
Basically, they're doing that.
Or leave it alone.
That, Tom?
I'm going to tell you up front that basically when I started this parade or show, whatever you wanted to call it, I was the proponent that stopped 50% representation because I want an ambulance service that's run for the people, not for a specific town or organization who has autonomy or the ability to squash everybody else. It doesn't make good partners. It's not what Congress does. It's not what Senate does. It doesn't create any. Pardon?
They don't work either.
Oh, they used to. And we're in our infant stage. We hopefully will work.
That's exactly what Senate does. But
the reality of it is, we have a great working relationship, and whether or not Deerfield had 51% of the vote, there is only one thing that would have changed in the whole time sitting in this arena, and I'd rather not go into that one thing, but that's all that has changed, and we have an outstanding working relationship with everybody bringing to the table the same tools, thought process, and needs. It's symbolic, it's whatever you want to go with it. If there was a problem and we tried to fix the high school by one man, one vote articles, we spend a hell of a lot of money, and I'll go back to Mary's statement, it don't work either. It hasn't fixed anything, it's not going to, because all it does is create yanks in the process. The other two towns voted for a third member, and I can see that in the conversation, since fiscal agents now has two definitions, that we probably have to clean that up, because it's going to be a third voting member, not the person responsible for firing, hiring, and otherwise. They did it against my recommendations to this date. I think that the organization that we have is outstanding and is giving the town of Deerfield a super service, and basically the town of Deerfield is using more than 50% of the service, so we're getting more than we asked for in that aspect for it. And if we want to pay for more of it by call volume and stuff, we could have conversations till the cows come home. The system is working. I ask you to, and this is in your arena, so this is to answer your question, Jack. I ask the townspeople to live with it until it's broken, and don't try to fix something that's not broken. And that's where I came from.
I have all the respect for Sunderland, Whately, and Deerfield, and the efforts. That's not the issue. But I have sat on plenty of committees over my career, and what starts out day one, everybody getting along in that, and I think it's great, and I'm glad we are. But 10 years down the road, it's not the same animal. You know it and I know it. People change, agendas change, and so on and so forth. So,
Jeff?
Yep.
I would say the biggest difference in our agreement and is that in that agreement, you're going to find that if something is egregious to the town of Deerfield or Sundown or Whiteley, mm-hmm. we have a very simple vote and we're out in 1 year. 1 year in your route. We can't do that at Frontier. Frontier's voted no against a Frontier. Sundown has voted no against a Frontier budget a couple of times, and the other three towns have voted yes, so we ended up paying.
Mm-hmm.
And that's always been a tough pill to swallow.
Of course it has.
Yeah, but in this, I think the one thing in this, bottom line, I was looking at your ballot, and we talk about the one man, one vote. You know there's one position in the town of Deerfield that doesn't have somebody running for it this year? You'd have to know what that position is.
Personnel board?
No, it's the school committee.
School committee member.
I saw that.
I would say, in the bottom line, and again, I said, and Jack, I think Jack will agree with me. I said from the beginning, it doesn't bother me because I think the only people you're going to get that are going to serve on the board of oversight are people that are interested and dedicated to the ambulance service.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that goes across all town lines. I said that from the beginning. I really do. I think, you know, right now we have some selectmen on it just because we wanted to get the thing pushed and move forward. But I would say probably next 2 or 3 years, it probably is going to be people that used to be on the ambulance system or that are involved with that. I don't think, and I don't really think it's going to matter if they're from Deerfield or Sundown or Whiteley.
Mm-hmm.
I think the protection lies in the MOU, and basically it says that if you don't like what's going on, you're out in a year. And no one can stop you. You know, there's no, and I think that's a lot of power. That's, and most places don't have that. Most agreements don't have that. I do think there's a check and balance inside there. But I can go either way. I don't, to me it doesn't matter.
I understand what you're saying. I appreciate the insight.
I think we have a question in the back. Yep.
Actually, two comments. One, if you're trying to clean it up, maybe insert along with the terms of the terms of the members is to change it to appointing two members other than selectmen. And the other comment would be to maybe bring it to time frame. The contract runs from January, and your fiscal year runs from June 30 or July 1st. So come the next three-year contract, you're actually going to be budgeted 6 months beyond where contract expires. So those should be brought into sync if you're going to do, if you're going to start trying to clean up the memorandum.
The intermunicipal agreement doesn't have anything to do with the budget, though.
No, well, it was brought up here, and I understand that, but.
Well, I mean to say that. The IMA can renew or not, but the budget is independent of that, the appropriation.
Well, that's what I'm saying. But you're asking for appropriation beyond the point that the contract expires. The contract expires on January 1st.
Contract and the fiscal year are two different things.
We know, and basically opt-out gets you that crossover for that six-month period of time.
Can you write that down? I ran out of space. As far as the first part about not having a selectman, damn, I'd hate not going to another meeting.
Well,
I'd hate that.
You can sit in the audience.
I'll sit in the audience, yeah.
I guess, Mary, did you have a question? Or you just no. One last comment I'd make, looking back at these budgets, is, you know, when I look at this for FY17, it really makes me not worry, but wonder about FY18. When I look at, you have an operating expense or operating budget that is higher by, call it $50,000. That mm-hmm. you have the projected revenues, which you said may go up to help cover some of any cost increases. But then we also have the 60,000 retained earnings, which we may not be able to do that consistently every year. And then, as I understand now, we don't have any capital requests this year funded from town assessments that we'll probably have again next year. So do you guys have any concerns about, and I know this is beyond this, so I don't want to spend a lot of time on it. Maybe you can, this is something we pick up again, but do you have concerns about FY18 and bridging the gap of some of these one-time things?
Absolutely.
No question.
Okay.
That's why the 140 was very, that why putting the 140 was a very,
very long conversation.
It was a long, I agree with you.
I honestly believe the budget is right for when nothing else. Entopia is a great, it's right where it probably should be with moving the line items around. So giving $140,000 out of that is setting myself up for failure in 18 or 19. But I hope I'm wrong. And with the projection of over $500,000 in revenue,
maybe okay.
Maybe okay without any problem at all.
I would like to see the 50,000, at least for the ambulance or whatever that number, 51,000. I would like to see that in there.
Well, and the hard part of it is we don't have the mechanism to put it in place, which Doug is articulating to us. Yeah. And we are going to take it and put it in there, but it's going to go into an ambulance.
Well,
and the next year's line item is being covered also if we don't have any money to put into that line item because we're actually doing it a year earlier than we anticipate. So you're right. It's in there, but we don't have the way, language-wise, in our budgets to put it in so that you can see it on paper. It's in there. It's just not in the pot that I want to see it in. And
we can find a way of putting it in there.
Well, Doug's working on
the $50,000.
We're restructuring so we can.
Yeah.
And we want to keep it completely isolated so that we know where the monies are going. And it doesn't give you that roller coaster ride of a budget going up and down when you take a line item out for the ambulance.
In fact, the MOU specifies that we're supposed to have a separate capital account.
Correct. And that has not yet been created. Yep.
So we're working on it. But and again, not to make light of the budgetary processes, but we're figuring it out.
Yep. Well, thank you. Any more questions or comments from the back, actually? Thank you guys for hanging in there the whole time, and all you guys as well. And thank you very much for coming in. I think this was very productive. We may have some follow-up questions either that people think of later. We have a few things that Tom has made a list of that we may hear back. And as with other budgets that are complex like this, we usually wait a week to vote them just to let everybody kind of digest everything we heard and pick it up to vote on it probably next week.
Is that going to be able to come tomorrow night, the Capitol meeting? There's an article on their agenda tomorrow night at 5:30 for an ambulance.
Correct. I'm not sure if he's informed of that meeting. I will be present at that for what that's worth, and I can speak to it, but I will check to see if Zach can make it.
All right. We have to do something, and this is from the town of Deerfield side. We have to do something for that $57,000 we collect. So he'll be there to represent us.
Thank you. That'll be half of the $57,000. We'll pick up the other $57,000 next week.
Is that it?
I'm just glad Jack knows now that Sunderland actually paid and we were given the money back. You didn't know that, did you?
No, I did not.
I accept. I accept that apology.
All right. So we will plan to meet next Tuesday at 6:30. Does anyone else have anything else to add before we call it a night?
What's the date next Tuesday?
29th.
Okay. So on the week from tomorrow, we're meeting.
30th is the public hearing for South County, still in Whately Town Office, that location, at 7 p.m., I believe.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Do I have any motion to adjourn?
You do.
Yes. No?
What's on the agenda for next week?
Next week, we're going to be meeting with Kevin to go over wastewater, and then John Paresky's coming in, and we're going over capital items with him, and Kevin obviously has a lot to say about many of them.
Okay. Thank you, guys. Appreciate the work you do.
Thank you. So, Edwin, do I have a second?
Second.
And all those in favor?
Aye.
All right.